The shop and then.
I can't do that.
You haven't tried.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening. It is the December 10th meeting of the Municipal Budget Committee. The year is 2015. Everybody would rise, pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I'm going to start around the room with a roll call of all the way, and our guest tonight as well. As you know, we have remote secretary, so we need to identify to her who is in the room tonight. Starting with you, Mr. Brown.
Nick Brattle.
Scott Blair.
Mike Pierce.
Hunter Kravitz.
Bob Ladd.
Jamal Lachlan.
Brian Lapham.
Eileen Latimer.
Jones.
Sandra Nickerson.
Mike Clough.
Garzano here.
Phil Bean.
Jen Hale.
Chris Jacobs.
Teresa McGinnis.
Thank you. As you know, this evening we are going to work on the DPW budget. So I'm going to get right into that and leave any other business for the end so that we don't keep Chris and Jennifer and Teresa any longer than we have to. All right. Page numbers, Brian?
14.
Yep. OBS 14 and page 35. I think you have different books than we do as far as the OBS.
Mm-hmm. We have the same page, at least the same
right.
Page numbers, which is good.
What we've done, Chris, is we've taken it section by section. You know, we sent you quite a few questions, and we thank you because you managed to get them all back to us by the end of the day today, and that was very good. Some people I know are just reading them, so I apologize ahead of time if we ask questions that have already been answered. But what we've done is we've gone about the review, taking section by section, and just stopping after that section in case anyone has any questions. So I'll let you start it with on page 35.
Under administration.
What did we get there? We've got highways and under administration.
Yeah. All right. I think I should just explain to the board overall what how we looked at the budget, how we prepared it. That may give you some insight as to what we were thinking. It was good to get your questions to us ahead of time because it let us know what you were thinking, how you'd already reviewed it, what your questions were more than likely going to be. It was very helpful. When the town manager tasked us with putting together the budget, it was requested that we have basically a zero increase or less. We did have the opportunity this year in May and June to bid out recycling and transportation and refuse hauling. That gave us a net reduction in what projected in this year's budget around $59,000. But overall, when I sat with Jen and Teresa, the idea was to put together a budget that showed truth in spending. Taking an ad, something that you see on TV, you know, the truth in the lending laws all the time with any banking ad. I felt that what we should tell you is, you know, truth in spending. So you see a lot of lines here that, especially the lines I have no control over, meaning like the electrical or utility bills. While I can try and shut off my lights in my office, I can't shut off street lights. So there's a truth in lending or truth in spending on that particular line, along with a couple of others, especially like the wastewater treatment plant. The strength of the effluent I get, I cannot control. the sensors in the aeration lagoons sense what the, how much air needs to be added. There's actually sensors in there that the blowers automatically kick on, and they take a lot of electricity. That's where a great part of the electricity use. So I don't really have any control over that. It really is dependent on how busy the beach area is during the summer, how much brewery waste Smutty Nose sends me and when they send it, things of that nature. Related to that is also like chemicals in the wastewater treatment plant. I have no real control over those. I have to meter in, let's say, chlorine and the chlorine content based upon the number of bugs that are in there, what I have to kill. So it goes up and down. Yes, we try and meter it. Matter of fact, if you ever came over the chlorine contact, it's imperceptible because it's actually literally dripping in. But it drips in 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. It's a constant flow. Other things like vehicle maintenance, I do have some control over that. Between Jen and I and Teresa, working with the mechanics, we do question a lot of things that get repaired. There's been a number of vehicles that have been sidelined this year in an attempt to stall, because you can't ignore it eventually, some of the vehicle repairs, particularly those vehicles that we use for snow removal, for snow fighting operations. And we use pretty much every piece of thing that has four rubber tires or six rubber tires we use for that operation. Having said that, the other part of the task that's been changed since I've been in charge since early April is when we spend money, let's get something done. You saw that in sidewalks outside of this building where trip hazard, working within the various, all three departments, sewer and drain, highway. We jackhammered those sidewalks up, took them out, installed some paving in some areas and reinstalled sidewalks in others. We had trees that we removed around town, High Street Cemetery, Langdale, North Shore Road, and then we've identified almost another 20 trees that, you know, if I had the money, they'd be coming down this month. And we got a lot of paving done this year. Fairfield, Ruth, Belmont, those are streets that were held over, but you saw Exeter Road paved. And then when we realized that we had sufficient funds left over, we figured out with the contractor how to get Toll Farm Road paved. So this is also an action budget, meaning that I know in the past people have said, you know, you look at things like tree removal and sidewalks, and they always seem to be the proverbial can that got kicked down the street. I don't look at them that way. I've already got here in the front of the book, and Jen's got a number of them, work orders that we're prepared to sign January 1 to get things done. Things will get done. Trees will get taken down. Sidewalks will get replaced. And if the warrant articles for paving get approved, you'll see streets paved. Having said that, yeah, let's go into the budget. There isn't a lot of wholesale change. The number of staff that we have is just that, the number of staff we have. The only thing that has changed with respect to the wages, and Teresa's here to respond more directly to those, is the people that had changes in step or cost of living increases under approved contracts. The only thing or only issues or questions that I have is all the way actually on the next page when it comes to drug and alcohol testing. In this last week, we've been notified that it's the possibility in the future that all the drivers are going to be required, along with their CDL license, to carry a medical card. We're trying to get a clarification from the State Department of Transportation on that. We don't have one yet, but that's one of those things that if it gets mandated from the federal level down through the state level, then we have to issue medical cards and get all of our drivers, for those that don't know, all the staff have, it's required by their hiring agreement that they have a CDL Class B license. They maintain it in good health. Federally, all the CDL drivers, A's and B's, have to have medical cards. if you, in the past, if you have worked for a municipality, you're only driving within the state, you haven't had to have one. Feds have kind of tightened that loophole up and said, hey, everybody's going to have to. Will that line get affected? Sure. Do I know how much? No. Will it be made up from somewhere else? More than likely. Staff development rate remains the same at 3,500. I know one of the questions that Jerry had is, how come you haven't spent anything this year? Four-letter word, dirty word, snow. Went up, spent in excess, what, 350% out of that particular line just to get snow removed. Everyone remembers, for those who weren't here, you know, when you couldn't go down D Street, they opened up the doors of the fire truck and the firefighters stood out in the snowbanks without even having to step down. That's when police, fire, town management, board of selectmen, along with our office, got together and said, you have to take care of the snow. You have to get it out of there. You have to remove it. It's a fire hazard. It's a safety hazard. I didn't spend it because I wanted to. I spent it because it needed to get spent. So when you saw, particularly with this year's budget, I think at this point, last Teresa told me I'm something still possibly $88,000 in the red. When I started in April in this position, I was $300 in the red. I think I've done a fairly decent job with the support of others of keeping it in line and bringing it down. We may actually skid in the black, but that will be the grace of some financial gods or whatever, and Murphy not showing up. One of Jerry's questions came back, uniform rentals, why, I'm three quarters of the way down the sheet on page 36. Why is that more? Boots. Sometime last year, we had a discussion with a number of the employees about wearing safety boots. Got down to reading the actual contract. They didn't realize that it said that they could get a pair of boots every single year. They thought it was like a pair of boots per life, I think, and like a one-time replacement of $50. Now that they've all realized that they don't have to wear that blown-out set of boots, they get them replaced once a year. I tell you, a lot of them, the boots don't even make it the year. They either rot out due to moisture or other conditions, especially if they're paving. So that we've had an increased usage of the boot allowance, but for safety reasons. And I support that 100%. Safety is job one. Item like building maintenance, 10,000. You say, you know, things in here says repairs to the storage barn roofs, annual cleaning of waste oil burner, programmable thermostats. Some little gift that I brought here tonight is our staff meeting yesterday was disrupted at 10 o'clock by a fire and electrical panel. That's a 30-amp breaker that fried, cooked the panel, tied to the blower. Somewhat, Dennis tells me now, an over 25-year-old blower, drawing 42 amps through a 30-amp breaker. You've got a 1967 building with a 1986 or 87 addition, things are going to need to get repaired. So when I spend money out of that line, it's just really to address things like that. That's going to be a new, out of that line is going to come a new electrical panel, and out of a different line, it's going to come a new compressor. Just needs, it needs to happen. So these things are, in some respects, unavoidable. The gasoline and diesel fuel, if you have questions on those lines, Christy has told me she'd like to answer those because they're implementing a new gas purchasing plan. It has to do with individual cards being issued. And we're going to be able to buy pretty much at any gas station around town, although in a state of an emergency, or if we're not able to get to those gas stations, still buy at the state barn. Let's see. Vehicle maintenance. The one thing I would like to point out, and I'm on page 37 on the top, and you see the oil and grease. That's a change this year. Finance Department recommended that we move the oil and grease that we use, and this is, we have about three different major grades of oils that we use. Two of the grades we buy in bulk. One's, I think it's a 5W30, and it's in a, almost a 300-gallon, like a home heating oil container, sits in the garage. And another one comes in 55-gallon drums that we buy from Wind River. So in an effort to save money, we do buy those types of things in bulk. But she's moved it from a typical vehicle maintenance line to an actual, or called it out as oil and grease. I think before, didn't it go under like fuels or something?
It was in the gasoline account.
Gasoline. So that's what brought that to that account. And with that, I'm down to the final total of administration, which I understand Eileen will go back and ask for comments.
Yeah, we'll go around the table. Hands up.
Yeah.
Jerry, I'll start over here.
Okay. Hi, Chris.
Hi, Jerry.
Only on this section, okay?
Yeah, administration. We're going to have to work together on this, because these two sets of responses, I'm not sure which response. I think maybe some of it might be to you, Scott.
Yeah.
And you put in questions.
And some of the responses are the same, because both ask.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks for making that easy. The
administration aspect of it, the headcount for this department, where the wages are $1,093,541, Chris?
Yep.
How many people are in that $1,093,541? And does it include that engineering tech position which is currently vacant?
It does.
Okay.
43 full-time and 2 permanent part-time people.
How come it doesn't add up when you start adding all these people up under the director and the deputy director and so on? I come up with 23.
Teresa, can you answer that?
I must be missing something here.
This is strictly the highway and 50% of the drain people.
Right. The 43 I gave you was the total.
For the department.
Yeah, I'm looking for this group here.
This is just
the $1,093,541. One, I count 23 here.
Right.
Is that the answer?
Yes.
Yeah.
So what are you going to have next year, for instance?
20.
All right, okay. That's all I wanted to know.
I have no money or no plans on
15 plus 16, okay.
Right.
Now, I was surprised to see the detailed wages that you're paying to the Hampton Police Department of $20,000. And I said, wow, the heck is this? The town clerk, when she has all of her voting going on and police officers are there, I didn't see a line item in her budget. Or when the fire department is put on a fire and the police are there to block off streets, I didn't see anything in their budget that I could recall anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Is it strictly RSA that drives you on this?
No, there's a town ordinance that
town
says
ordinance.
That police details are required when someone pulls a permit and is working within the road. Only thing that would offset that is if I get heavy-handed and close the road down permanently, which I haven't really done.
So these detailed wages really only apply to you? Doesn't apply to the town clerk? Fred, maybe you can help this, or the fire department?
Well, there again, Jerry, it's strictly an ordinance. I mean, Fred can jump in. I won't cut him off.
Yeah.
But there's an ordinance, and with respect to working within the street. Now, if I've got a crew out patching on Gale Road,
yeah,
way out,
yeah, I know,
western side of town,
yeah,
we won't ask for a crew for that.
I understand.
But if I was patching a year ago on Exeter Road, darn tootin', we're having a crew, because on Exeter Road people wouldn't slow down. Even Frank and I witnessed it.
So this is planned work.
Planned work.
Planned work, right. And where you raise your hand and you say, like, I need a detail here.
Right.
When a fire department is putting out a fire, like A block we had, and we had police there.
What kicks in there is once they lay down fire hoses, the road's closed.
Yeah.
And the on-call staff, I think, respond to it. A lot of my stuff is, I won't speak for police, but let's say they have 8 officers on duty that day. And we're talking the 13 weeks during the summer. Their hands are full. These are additional details. These are all construction-related details or safety-related details.
Same thing with voting, though. Everybody knows when the voting dates are.
They're required to be there for voting by law.
They are. They don't get charged for that by the town clerk,
or
the town clerk doesn't pay for that.
Comes out of the police budget.
Comes out of the police budget. I got you. Okay. stormwater requirements. Request is 10 grand. We have a history of spending questions if we have a planned program or not, because if we looked at zero spent year to date and 5,000 spent in 14 and 4,000 spent in 13, and you're asking for 10,000. So the question is, are we into this or not? And if we are, it's 10,000, that's the case, but we're not spending it.
Interesting that today, Representative Sanborn sent an email around as a notification. He was, basically, we were all aware of it, but he basically memorialized it, and I sent it along to your chairman, that the EPA has let everyone know they're going to issue this permit late March or early April.
To us.
To everybody in the state of New Hampshire.
Yeah.
It's going to mimic the permit that they released to the state of Massachusetts about a year ago. The money that I spent last year was, I got excited. That's probably not the good term. But we, proactive, thank you. That's a better one. I thought we had the money into the sign budget. So I purchased basically $5,000 worth of signs because I'm mandated to now identify, put a sign up next to every single outfall in the town. We have 160 of them. So we ordered, 100 posts, and I ordered 100 numbered signs, and I think I ordered 60 blank signs that I can put my own numbers on, because we always tend to find more than we think we have.
When you say outfalls, Chris, what is
wherever
that?
Wherever water passes through a controlled structure, catch basin system, and hard pipe, and then falls back into an open swale or stream or marsh, that's an outfall.
I see. So
all those under the new permit are going to need to be identified.
How many did we have?
160 is what we've initially identified. All those have to be located, tested, whether they're determined. There's going to be 7 parameters that they want us to test for: chlorides, turbidity, suspended solids, iron,
E. coli,
and something else. But there's 7, and that's only going to be the starting 7. What's really happening that I see is that stormwater is now going to be treated like wastewater. In the 70s, get the solids out of it, clean it up a little bit, and discharge it. And every year since the 70s, it's got, no, you have to make it cleaner and cleaner and cleaner and cleaner.
Yeah.
I think the same thing's going to happen with stormwater.
The outfalls.
Right. Well, not just the outfalls. There's a number of other areas that we're going to be required to spend money in. All the developers are going to have to go to annual testing or training put on by the municipality or supported by the municipality to train them how to manage turbidity and runoff from their sites. All the salt applicators are going to have to go to training. All the developers are going to have to go to training. It's going to be fun.
So, but getting back to what we've historically spent, you really have not historically spent in accordance with this line item.
Only because the permit never got released. See, initially I asked for 100,000, got cut to 50, and I think we've held it in as 10, but it's really not been even in the budget because of the default budgets. So I haven't really had a budget line.
Well, there's a budget line for this.
Default was.
The default budget, 10 grand.
Mm-hmm.
I think, yeah. But you haven't, like I say, zero to date, and in 2014 you spent 5 and 4,000 in 13. So it's just, you're saying it's permit driven.
Yes.
It's no longer going to be an option because the permit's going to be in hand.
Okay. Engineering request, is that under administration? We got so many segments in here. Mm-hmm. I had an engineering request. It was my next thought.
Oh, we're not there yet.
Then I'm done with it. My next comment will be with respect to engineering request of 40 grand.
Going around the table, anybody else for administration? Scott.
Yeah, thanks for the complete response and quick responses. Appreciate it very much. Your response to the wages, it was add $169,471 to October for actual use. Is that year-to-date through October? So if you want to annualize it, to make it comparable, that's what I would add?
Basically.
Okay, all right. And then, and just to follow up on Jerry, what you said, that detail, the detail wages in the past, we've spent it, but it's been spread around a number of different line items, I guess.
Two seasons ago, we paved the outer section of Exeter Road. We had a paving line that year of $606,000. I spent $598,000 paving, and I spent $16,000 for traffic details.
Okay.
Was needed, though.
Yep.
Okay. Don't dispute the amount. So part of it got eaten up from out of the paving line, if you will.
Yeah.
And part of it got eaten up from other lines.
So this is comparable to prior years.
Oh,
it's
sure.
Just identified, stripped out of those accounts and put into
right.
This one.
Okay. I think the former director wanted the budget committee to realize, the taxpayers to realize, a certain portion of our budget was being used for this purpose.
Yeah.
A significant amount. More than we spent for stormwater.
Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it.
Anybody else on administration? Okay, I just have one question. Chris, and might have to go to Christy too. On the detail that you're paying to police, is that money going into the detail fund and then out of that fund again? Christy?
No, it's not being run through the detail fund, no. It is marked on payroll and it's paid out of an internal detail account, which is in the police department. It usually ends up being $0, though, because it's all reimbursed through his budget.
Hey, I realize it'll be zeroed out somewhere, but I just want to know where I'd look for that, the accounting of that, what's being paid in detail.
Hold on, I'll get you the account number. Let me look here.
Okay, thank you.
It's 010023. 410023. Uh-huh. 4210619801980. And then the four zeros after, and it's in police, and it's under special details, and it's labeled as private detail internal. Every once in a while, you will see a little money sitting there, and it's just in regards to timing of getting it. Because what we do is, when we run it through payroll, we charge that account that I just gave you.
Mm-hmm.
And then we send down to Public Works to make sure that they agree with the details, and that they have the detail and want to pay it, you know. So, and then when they sign it, and then I do a journal entry. So in your budget book right there, right in the end of September, there was $418 on that line.
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee it's gone by now, or will be gone when I do my journal entries this month.
Then the next question I guess I have is, do you ever have, I don't have much of a voice tonight, so excuse me. Do you have occurrences where the detail is paid for by someone else, someone requiring the work to be done, or construction company, or an external interest, let's put it that way, necessitating the work?
That would be more a question
for them if they have it in their contract. It would all depend who's doing the work. If Aquarian is out there, Aquarian's paying for the detail. If Unitil is out there, Unitil's paying for the detail. When we did the High Street Lafayette Road drainage improvement project, it needed details. If the contractor pays it, we're just paying the contractor. So it stays, you know, separate, and there's details, and then the contractor's work. So if it's for the town, mm-hmm. we're paying for it.
So if it's for the town, it's coming out of this $20,000.
Right. And it worked done for the town by the town.
Okay.
Or contracted through
the If town. The detail is for an external source, the income comes in and goes where?
In the detail fund that you were talking about. Yeah.
It goes in the
fund
detail
26,
fund.
Fund 26, yes. It's okay. Paid out of fund 26 and it comes into fund 26, yes.
For DPW. Not police detail.
No.
I don't know that we
I
have
I guess that's
a
what I'm asking. Is
oh,
there ever an instance when DPW is called on site?
Oh.
All right, for an external vendor. Let's put it this way, non-internally.
If police details are ever called.
No, not police, DPW.
Oh, called out for anything?
Mm-hmm.
No, that's just
so you don't, that doesn't happen. There's not a time when.
We don't charge, if DPW is called out to look at something or to do something, it's related to.
Yeah, we don't charge for
it's
Seafood Festival. Mm-hmm. We don't charge for Barricades 4th of July. We don't, it's just part of our workload. There hasn't been a mechanism for us as a department to charge anyone else.
Well, Seafood Festival's probably a good example of an outside source that's requiring a detail from DPW, so we're not charging for that.
We do charge, we do Chop Fest, absolutely. The Seafood Fest, we do.
Not wages?
Oh, not wages?
Yeah, not labor time.
Right, not labor time. That's going to change real fast, there's an order you can charge for labor. That's mine.
So we're not charging, we're charging for equipment and material only and not for labor. I'm not looking to pick on Seafood Festival.
Right.
I'm just asking that there are externally times when a detail would be needed. So does that look like it's going to change anytime in the future?
Not that I'm aware. It would have to be, there would have to be a
I'm just asking if it's in flux.
There would have to be a change in business operations for us to do that.
All right, and I don't have any more questions on this.
More people we do charge though for is when we work on police vehicles, we do send a corresponding labor account, which is transferred back. That would be the only other transfer, interdepartment transfer.
We won't grill you on that one, Chris, because we've already run that down with the police department. We understand how that's working.
Right.
No, just curious on the outside since we're looking at paying for detail.
Yeah, I'm curious. In your opinion, are any areas that you increase the revenue?
Who brings in revenue for wastewater?
I bring in revenue for the transfer station. We do, you know, that's about $160,000, but it's offset by probably $100,000 in costs. We do bring in over $100,000 for sludge, septic waste deposited at the septic receiving area. I can't get too carried away with adjusting those prices in both of those areas. If I did, let's say I charged $20 for a mattress to increase prices, I'd spend $20 going around town picking them up. So it's kind of an oxymoron. With respect to sludge, we check our per gallon disposal rate compared to other towns. We don't want to be too high, yet we won't want to be too low. We actually need some of it as food for strange reasons. Yeah, it's it's all for the bugs. Yeah. Another source of revenue is we now charging the sewer access fee. That's been a fairly good one this past 2 years. We do make some money with respect to you know, driveway permits, sewer connection permits, trench permits, but more or less the fees are adjusted to offset the labor that was put into them. So they're not really set up as pure, from a business perspective, revenue stream. That's all that I can, right off the top of my head, think
all
about.
All right, thank you, Sonny. Let's move on now to...
Can I have just one thing to say?
Sure.
I'm a little disappointed in hearing about that we haven't been receiving money from the Seafood Festival for your work in these other areas. I believe Fred says that's going to change, but I've been told just the opposite in the last few years, and I'm a little upset about it because I was under the impression you were getting reimbursed for what you were doing. And that's my only comment.
Just for the, you know, for the material things that they rent, for instance, the
your time and everything else.
But I think, and that's always an evolving thing. It's not really up to me to decide when to charge, when not to charge.
No, I understand that. I'm just making a comment that.
But in the past, it's been because the department supports the residents. We serve the people. You know, the July 4th barricades to me are like, it's a town function. It's what makes Hampton what it is. I'd almost be, I'd feel bad if we didn't support that endeavor, if you know what I mean.
I can accept those.
And I think that's how maybe the seafood festival got started, is that it started out as a 30,000-person event and helps the business community, helps the town as a whole.
And started, and now it's a multi-million dollar event. This really needs to be looked into.
We do the same thing with, you know, all the road race events, you know, putting up message boards. All things that go to serve the people that reside in this community and enjoy and participate in those things.
Thank you.
Yep.
Sorry.
Oh, no problem.
All right, let's move on down now to engineering, and that's just one line of shows for everyone.
There's no increase of this for 16.
Right.
But I see very cyclic spending going on here, Chris, you know, from year to year. You're asking $40,000.
Yep.
You spent $9,000 year to date from October. I didn't annualize it. Previous 4 years went $14,000, $31,000, $60,000, $27,000. And you're asking for $40,000 this year. It seems erratic to me. Sawtooth. Cyclic. And do we have a plan here for 16? If so, what is the role of this effort here?
We do. You are correct, though, that the engineering effort can be cyclical in nature. It can be, I'll give you for instance, there's a number of things that are hitting on the department this year. You've got a proposed hotel and elderly care facility, two different separate applications out in the Liberty Lane, Exeter Road area. Both of those people, both of those uses will actually flow through a portion of the wastewater system not under our control, mainly a pump station on Liberty Lane that is privately owned. We are in need of and actually have a consultant on staff that is helping us determine what steps we need to take to ensure that that system can handle it, that that pump station can handle it. Because I don't know if you're aware, but if that pump station were to overflow in the middle of the night, I have to respond to the EPA. Why did a pump station within your corporate limits overflow?
Mm-hmm.
And it's not my pump station. So I am being held responsible by the EPA.
Yeah.
So as a cyclical response, an application before the planning board requires me to hire out engineering services.
Do we have to service that pump station regularly?
No.
So we don't do any PM on that pump.
Right. But in the past, we have been called to address an issue there. We helped. We called people. We got people in to handle it for them. We facilitated the repair, if you will, making a few phone calls, pushing the right buttons, then backed off. So we have been called to that particular station in the past. Mm-hmm. So from a cyclical basis, yes, we have those things that do come up.
Do they have a PM plan?
Don't know. That's what we're trying to get through with them. We're trying to get our consultant, we're trying to get a full-blown inspection, get a third-party analysis, and hopefully pass this back through as an engineering cost through the development process.
So give me 2 to 3 bullets that would speak to the 16 plan you might have for this $40,000.
Asset management software, purchase and implementation. We have some wetland permit, Eaton Park. I have a possible wetlands permit under consideration to Joanne. I have
Eaton Park, a permit?
Yeah. Brown Ave tide gate needs to be put back on.
So those are some of the ones that the engineering when we get to the storm and drainage, but under the highway engineering, due to the sea rise and things like that, we want to do a critical infrastructure study. That would be some of the engineering that would go on. Mm-hmm. We also, when the engineering tech left, a lot of the continuous updates to our GIS system, all the mapping and those type of things, they're piling up, and you know there are consultants out there that can come in and do it much faster and cheaper. Then taking the labor away from our office to do it. So those are some of the things that are planned out of the highway budget.
This is fine. I would only comment that if that rationale had been in the budget board, I would never ask the question. But that's good rationale, and we'll see how much you've spent next year.
Sure.
That's all I have for engineering.
Any other questions on engineering? Okay. Moving on to the next section.
Maintenance is what I had. I don't know what else.
Yeah, there's total paving and maintenance. We normally, and I'm at the bottom of page 37, those following along.
Yeah.
Resurfacing, 300 tons of resurfacing money. For $22,500 patch material. If you flip to 38, under that, we also do line painting, but that's a contractual number. We bid that out. We know what that's going to cost us. I also put a note on here, we're being asked every year to do more and more. For instance, the parking control situation that was implemented along the numbered streets required no parking and striping along the at each end of those numbered streets. That doesn't come cheap. It's priced out by the letter and by the foot of line. So all that gets added, but those are contractual costs. We do carry $5,000 to rent equipment. To give you an example of what we do with that is the cat loaders. We have three loaders. Two of them are cat loaders. They've both had to go back up to HP Fairfield or the cat dealer, I guess it's Milton Cat, for work. We rent a low bed to transfer those pieces of equipment up there. We've had backhoes go up. We've rented. That's where that line would come out. If we were to happen to take on a bigger paving job and needed a heavier roller, we might rent one. That's where that might come from. But a lot of times that's transportation. The lawn care is a pass-through. It's a number I'm given and been given. It's a contractual number. It comes in and comes out. Tree maintenance has stayed at $25,000, but as I said, I have 17 to 20 trees to take down that have been identified. Five Corners Park, Lock Road Park, Drakeside Road, there's dead trees.
Five Corners.
I can send you the list, Jerry. There's 20.
Yeah,
38 Acadia, there's a huge ash. 41 Little River Road, there's three rather large dead pine trees that are just waiting to crash down. They've been identified.
Okay.
If I had the money today, I'd spend it.
So, again, though, you've not spent it in the past. So you're going to have a stepped-up program this year to go out and spend it and get these trees down, I guess, right?
As you've seen around town, this is a department that's been taking action. Please don't judge the three of us by what the department has or hasn't done in prior years. If you give us the money, we will be cutting trees down like no tomorrow.
Year to date, though, you've spent $7,500. In the last 4 years, you've averaged $11,000 a year.
Snow.
Snow got
34-letter word.
But the devil went away.
Exactly. I hadn't paid for snow.
Well, you've certainly identified the trees.
We have identified the trees.
We have identified them, and we even have the estimates to take them down.
And I've got the work orders.
What total up to be? You clicked off a number of items. It sounds like $50,000.
I could spend $25,000 tomorrow.
Yep.
I've got work orders for in probably right now at about $10,000. There's one right there from Urban Tree. $2,800, $300, $475. Add those together, and that's only one group of trees. So it's
you really you don't look to take these some of these down this month. You're still kind of running tight with your budget.
If Fred calls me at Christmas time and says, "Merry Christmas, you got $5,000 left in your budget," I will spend that so quickly.
You don't even go to bed.
New chance for the budget committee.
You don't even go to bed. You'll just get on that phone.
Well, no, that's why these estimates are already in hand. We will just literally call Urban and say, "Go."
Some poor person may wake up on Christmas morning in a tree.
Well, no. I don't think they'll do a Christmas morning, but it'll get done.
Yeah.
They'll hear the noise. I think it's Santa Claus.
Yeah, we not want some wood?
You can eat the milk and cookies.
Yeah, exactly. And street signs. We're still in a process. The 8,000 is, we are still in the midst of a 2017 federal deadline to make all the street signs. They're all supposed to be 6-inch high letters instead of 4-inch high letters. I would think that we're somewhere about halfway through. We actually have a sign program but because of that dirty four-letter word, we suspended that program.
Six-inch high letters?
Yeah, the feds have mandated
I'm glad to hear that.
All the,
so you can see them.
So you can see
them. Yeah. No, I can turn into my street, maybe. And
so, yeah, so that's in progress.
Okay.
I don't know how far on this one you want me to go down, because it goes through.
No, I stopped at tree maintenance. I went over this section very carefully, and I had rationalized in my own mind just what you had here and what I was okay with, compatibly speaking, and I just got hung up with this tree business that we continually ask for money and we don't get these trees down. But I understand what you're saying. So I'm now on sidewalks and curbs, okay. Madam Chairman.
All right, Chris, why don't you take it down to
Before we leave that one, okay. In your response there, we had questioned, you had asked for $5,000, and you're thinking it really should have been $17,000. Will you be asking for a change in the budget for that's under the hired equipment summer?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was something that when you had asked the question, Teresa and I did go back and looked at it, and the selectmen's meeting was...
Where is that?
A few months.
What they're referring to is
2 months ago.
We have an outside contract, and as Fred has pointed out to me, this will be in the default budget request. But we have a contract with Katie Landscaping. I believe it's $17,500.
$14,600.
Thank you. To rake Sun Valley Beach. They use a $50,000 specialized piece of equipment that's the same contractor we've used the last 3 years. And I've had zero complaints about them and their service. It's been very timely. He's one of the few contractors that makes a very strong effort to stay in touch with me. Hey, I'm cleaning today. I'm not cleaning today.
So would you go back to the selectmen and ask to add?
We already did. Within the last 30 days, they've reapproved that contract.
So that was done September 28th. They had reapproved that contract. It did not get translated into the paperwork that we had.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So we need to make that adjustment.
So what was that thing again, Scott?
Instead of being 5,000, it would go to 17,300, the same as the line item below it, I think.
Lawn care.
Because it's hired equipment summer.
Hired equipment summer.
And it's annualized this year, 17,300.
Yeah.
I think what you're saying is it's going to be the same next year. Because mm-hmm. there's a contract for 99% of it.
Well, the 17.3 is actually for mowing. That's its own separate mowing.
That's line. A separate, yeah. Lawn care is separate than hired equipment. So when I saw that, I
think you're going to see the 5,000 go to 9. If you take 14 and 5, you go to 19.6.
Okay.
19.6.
Why don't we have Christy change that in her notes, and when we get closer to the end, she'll already have it.
So. And hired equipment summer is going to go to 19.6. Why is that again?
Beach raking.
Katie Landscaping.
That's at the Sun Valley.
Mm-hmm.
And
what was it called? 19.6.
So the 5K goes out then. 19.6 goes in there.
Right.
Hired equipment.
Madam Chair, you want me to go to what line? Or which section?
Madam Chair, I just had a quick question on this. Does evacuation route signage come under your jurisdiction?
It would. You realize I don't have any? It's in the budget this year. I feel the need strongly to make sure that we have the signs.
Right. Thank you.
Yep. We can't put them up on state highways.
Highland Avenue and Church Street, that you could.
Where is it? They're state highways.
Where is it, Mike?
Any other questions right now?
But at least it would be nice to have them, know where they are as part of our emergency operations plan and where they would go and who would put them up and probably pre-erect signs, signed posts to put them on.
Thank
you, Harry. No, but it was, it's something that Jennifer and I picked up on the last, we had an EOC center training about a month ago and we both had one of those light bulb moments that said, quite not prepared for that, so we'll get those.
So who does it on the state highways?
State. There's a statute that forbids us to do anything on state highways for signage.
I didn't understand that part, but if it's a Hampton evacuation, why wouldn't they, we'd have to tell them where we want them?
Well, no, the state, the evacuation system is a state-ordered evacuation system. They just won't pay for the signs.
Oh, so this is necessarily a Hampton function?
No, no.
Okay, got you. Thank you.
Okay, Chris, if you would take us all the way up to, it's a small section, but through the snow and ice, or up to it, snow and ice.
Okay.
Yep.
Continuing on then, middle side of page 38. Drainage construction, there's $30,000 in there for repairs and maintenance, and $30,000 actually for drainage construction itself. There again, this is probably that dirty four-letter word has kicked the daylights out of this in the past, but we actually have identified about 8,000 linear feet of corrugated metal pipe in this town. A lot of it does not have a bottom anymore. It's eroded away due to acidity of the rain. We have prioritized some of that, and we're prepared to move forward on areas like Langdale Circle, St. Cyr, Falcone Circle. We previously mentioned the Eaton Park, and we'd like to get some combined drainage work also done along, it says Lafayette Road at Captain's Cove, but I want you to know that that couldn't wait, and that's already been done. We realized there that somebody'd made a repair of a 21-inch pipe with an 8-inch pipe, and it wasn't working. So we got that done already. Decided that just couldn't wait. Sidewalks and curbs, again, we're asking for 26. I just want to tell you that the department's figured out how to take action, and that is mobilize all the forces. We're using the sewer and drain guys with their ability to demo to take apart the sidewalks, and we'll get the highway guys to carry the old sidewalk away and regrade. And I've gotten my two carpenters trained to actually install sidewalks. I actually hired a mason this past summer. He gave him the two-day mini workshop here around town, went with him to A.H. Harris, where they bought close to $2,000 in special screeds and rakes and forms and all sorts of fun stuff. And they're going to actually be teaching two of the younger guys this summer on how to do that. So our plan is to move forward over here on Toll with those sidewalks, because we identified so close to the school and in such poor condition that would be, and there's such a straight run, that that would be a great place to start. We'll learn a lot, but we'll definitely get $26,000 worth of sidewalk done this year. You can.
Is there a separate warrant article for the sidewalks? I don't want to discuss warrant articles, yeah. But just so it'll be this 26 plus.
Yeah, there was a warrant article that selectmen backed 4-1.
It has to be in the top five, then, right? Did you get the top? Was that in the top five?
And then my question on the sidewalks, listening to your description of the materials purchased, we're talking about working on concrete sidewalks going forward, not the blacktop sidewalks.
Oh, no, both.
Both? On this one, on Toll, talking about concrete?
And that's, it'll go stay concrete.
Will you be sealing that at the same time?
Yes. The idea is that if you don't seal within 1 year, don't waste the money doing it. So let's say they get installed in June, I'd seal them by, let's say, September. I do have to give them a period of time to cure.
Mm-hmm. But within the same calendar year, you should see it being sealed.
I have a question about sidewalks.
Yep.
Oh, 3 or 4 years ago, maybe 5 years ago, there was an issue made about a sidewalk on Atlantic Avenue. Do you ever look at any of those asphalt sidewalks down there? Because what they've done over the years, people have driven over it, and it was just down, and it was a mess between this asphalt street and the sidewalk. And we filled that all in prior to your time. And I was hoping they'd do the sidewalk to get that built up. Do you ever take a look at those down there to see what they might need?
We are.
That's my question.
But I think the Atlantic neighborhood was also being done in coordination with probably an examination of the parking.
Okay.
And that if we were going to do something with a sidewalk or recapture a sidewalk that had been paved over as like a shoulder, that we would only want to do it in combination or coordination with police and fire, So it's a whole process of fire lane determination. We actually, the three of us get together and walk or ride those streets. So the answer is yes, but would it be high on my agenda right off the bat? Probably no.
Well, the reason why I ask is because it looked like to me over the years they kept driving over it.
Yep.
So they could just park in their front yard, so to speak. And it's, if we just lay another asphalt sidewalk walk like it's been there whenever it was done, it's just going to fall apart again.
The idea has been that, like I know we've discussed, Concord, Boston, Haverhill, Epping, those streets off of the south end of the beach. The idea being there that we'd actually do additional striping to define what is the town's travel way, i.e. what we need to keep open for a safety lane.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, determine where sidewalks would be, parking would be, things of that nature. So we're not trying to, we're trying to do a coordinated between the three departments and treat it as a safety issue, right, and a pedestrian issue.
But we can't really control people parking in the middle of the front yard where there isn't really a driveway, can we? Or can we?
Not if they're on the line.
I mean, we have driveway regulations, but you're right. There are some parts of town that, you know, the structure's been there since, you know, I know Fort Atlantic.
Mm-hmm.
It's been there since 1900. I just saw that, the card on it. The whole front yard was, since 1900, been a parking lot. So,
yeah.
Right, they never came to this, to our department for a driveway permit, and that one was never required. So in situations like that, you're right. I don't really have much authority.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I have.
Sunny?
Yeah. East, down the beach, these sidewalks along the beach, the concrete, is the state sealing them or?
No. They contend the sidewalks are ours. They built them. It's us to maintain.
Yeah. No, I understand.
Of course, we don't maintain. But also, at the same time, there's a big, they've hired consultants. They've started the discussion about a total reconstruction of that portion of Ocean Boulevard from there all the way past what?
Boar's Head.
Boar's Head, yeah. And they're looking at everything from, they realize now they can't just pave another lift on it. They're going to bury somebody or drown somebody. So there's a whole thing of discussion about drainage, parking, traffic. They've got a whole new plan in front of us, asking for our comments, whether we agree or disagree. They want to add some parking, take away some parking, move some parking, widen some sidewalks. Initially, it'll be their expense.
Yeah, be nice to have, when you pave a street, to put a bike path in.
That's on the plan.
The other question I have is on Liberty Lane's two projects. You know, the retirement home and the hotel. It would seem to me that if it's going to push the wastewater treatment plant up to capacity,
no,
it won't affect it, because the time to do it is to get the developers to pick the cost up.
Today's number, we're at 3.8 to 4 million MGD plant, million gallons a day. Today we're at 1.6. Only time we're stressed is those 13 weeks during the summer.
Yeah, so much, sure.
But there are other steps that we can take to ensure that we still have capacity. And we're doing that. And part of it's the development fund. But we're not at, or even closely approximating, coming close to our capacity.
Because I see what's happening in Portsmouth, so.
Yeah.
they were only a primary plant, that's why.
In a couple of years, there will need to be a, they call it a facility study under the 201 program. And we will need to look at when our capacity, the projection of when our capacity will be maxed out.
Tim?
Good evening, Chris.
Yes.
You mentioned the state sidewalks at the beach. Always a enjoyable topic for me. You also mentioned the state was putting some proposals together before you for your review?
Yes.
When you say the state, are you talking DOT or are you talking HBAC?
As DOT has hired VHB.
Yeah, through a grant process to do some feasibility master planning traffic study
proposals that have been presented, not only to the beach precinct, through multiple, I think there's been two public hearings. They were gracious enough to come in and sit with town department heads to make the presentation as well. Right now, they're soliciting feedback from their proposed, I want to call it master plans or design concepts.
So this was the same concept that was presented at Hampton Beach Area Commission, also known as HVAC. And you used a kind of interesting word when you said it was going to be paid for by the state, at least initially. The word initially kind of scares me. Can you elaborate on what that means in this context?
Well, using the word initially, for instance, when Lafayette Road was widened and improved, and then it was turned over to the responsibility of the town to plow and maintain the sidewalk, that's what I mean by initially. It's the state's desire that we accept responsibility of the sidewalks down there afterwards. Their motto is, we build and you maintain. You know, remember that lady that used to do the commercials,
Where's the Beef?
Has the town responded to that desire of the state?
Oh, they know how we feel. They know that we're not.
How do we feel?
No, is the word.
Excellent. No, excellent answer.
Okay.
No.
I think we'll leave it that for now.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I know that's always a topic of their discussion, so that's why.
As it is mine.
Yeah. I'm on the top of page 39. Salt and winter sand articles, lines. Salt. Need glasses. 80,245. Just to give you background information, this year we're buying from Granite State Minerals. We tack on to the state low bid. They bid it by area and region. We're going to be paying $51.73 a ton. To give you a comparison, last year we paid $48.43 a ton. 2013 we paid $48.37 a ton, difference of only cents. 2011 we paid $55.92 a ton. You can see the current price is actually lower than what we were paying four seasons ago. But the projected value is based upon we typically are around 1,400 tons annually. And right now I have about 200 ton in the shed. I have Frank's purchase order to buy another 15,000. I haven't signed it yet. Waiting for Sandy Welch to tell me to go ahead and buy.
So it's $51.73.
Yes, $51.73 a ton. Okay. Right. Question's been asked on winter sand. We have it at $13,877. How come we didn't buy any last year, or how come we haven't bought any so far this year? We haven't needed it yet. Let's say we bought 800 ton every year for the last 4 years. Well, I used maybe 600 or 700 of the ton. I've got a little extra in the bread box, as they say. I probably have 800 tons sitting on site right now.
Where is it anyway?
Right behind the salt shed.
It is behind
the salt. We moved it this year. It used to be on the east side of the building, but it struck me that it was too far away to be mixed to the salt shed, so I had it moved. We actually moved the compost further out.
So when you load your trucks with salt, you mix it with sand a little bit?
A lot of times I won't say we never, because that's not a good possibility to exist. If it's pure ice, yeah, I'm out with straight salt. But if it's on a lot of our side streets and even the main streets, it's sand for traction and salt to loosen it up.
So it's separate, separate
well,
trips.
We don't, no, we mix
you
it.
You mix
it. We use the, that's why the pile, we actually have what we call a mixed pile. We pre-mix salt and sand.
Gotcha.
And if that's what's called for, that's what they load up.
Oh, gotcha.
So that's all set. So I won't be buying any sand between now and the end of the year. But that dirty four-letter word took up, that was part of what I used to balance the books of, so to speak, this year. So I'm at the end of the snow and ice removal, total 191, 92. Any other questions?
No.
I am. The salt shed. Are we going to cover that this year?
I'll put doors on it.
I thought it was going to be covered.
You mean the doors?
Yes.
34-letter word.
Snow.
Yeah, we load from the end that faces the marsh, and we unload or load the trucks from the other end, because that's where the ramp is, that's where the light is for at night. What I can do is work with a contractor, solicit a price, but I didn't even, when we went through those first 3 weeks of February and saw what it did to the budget, that even came off the books of even picking up the phone to call.
I thought this was already something that was planned to be done.
Strong desire, not done.
So we waste the salt.
Not even priced out.
We waste the salt.
No, that's why we didn't fill, that's why the salt barn is not full. That's why there's only 200 ton, and it's kind of smack in the middle. Never got rained on. Water doesn't make it in that far. Nor does the sun.
I object to that, but okay. Thank you.
What were you going to plan? Doors or plastic strips coming down?
It's been a huge canvas tarp is one idea. It's been floated, you know. It's been a big rolling door. There's been a host
I thought maybe you'd use those individual plastic strips that hang down, a number of them across the entrance.
Yeah, mm-hmm. At least something to cover that up.
I agree. I agree with you totally.
Was there any plan for any of that in 16?
I am optimistic. I saw the weather forecast today. I'm a happy camper. Nothing going to happen.
I was a happy camper until February of last year, too.
Exactly. Well, if I can skate right till the end of the month, I'll tell you, it's going to be one. I'm going to pop a cork New Year's Eve. So, okay. Yeah. I mean, if that happens.
I went down and looked at it, and I saw mm-hmm. where the openings are situated and the way the wind goes through there.
Yeah, it's an east-west.
I cannot believe that they're not.
Yeah.
It's not subject to some melting at some time. But
I think I'm losing more to the pigeon dung than I am.
Yeah, that was also on my hat. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else in this section?
That's unfortunate.
Chris, I have one question for you here. The overtime wages under snow removal, obviously, that had to do with the winter that we had.
Yep.
And the estimate going forward, because the budget last year was for 46, now we're going up to 67.
We always knew that even the budget last year at 40
wasn't real.
Cut it.
Okay. I want to point out we did use 65 the year before. 14 was kind of snowy too, but hopefully. And the hired equipment, obviously. We're going backwards on that one, too. We're not going to pay attention to this refunding one, because we're going to hope we don't have a historical event again.
Yeah, the forecast tonight was that if it snows this, if you looked at the last 5 years where it snowed late in the year, and historically we've been under the 60 inches of snow for the rest of the year.
Mm-hmm.
And I think given the El Nino effect,
yeah.
I think the people to the north are going to get drilled, and I think right here along the coast we're not.
Did you ever think El Nino would be your friend?
No.
Okay, I think we can go on to the next section. This little bit under street lighting, why don't you take that and go through sanitation. And
okay.
We'll hold back any questions until after sanitation.
Sounds good. All right, traffic light repairs, the 4,000. It's in my budget, but it's being controlled by the fire department. They're the ones that call for the repairs or the lights. It has gone over, but it really is what they deem is necessary. The lights are their responsibility.
I don't quite understand that. Who does the actual repairs? You?
No.
A lot of times they call like electric light company to have them switch out the lights.
Why is it in their budget?
It's
always
been
in the state puts it in this budget.
State puts it in here.
Yeah, there's an accounting for it in a state system for this budget.
There's a reason for everything.
Mm-hmm.
Electric, that's the street light usage. Again, that goes back to the truth in spending. To give you some numbers, 2013 we spent just over $206,000. 2014 we spent just under $213, or a jump of $6,800. Essentially, what we did is we took the 214 number, added the 6,000 to it. In other words, we went 213 plus 6 to 219. We're projecting that it will cost us 219. It's just a truth in spending. It's nothing I have any control over. Number of lights times the number of days times the rate. They come in, they go out. Mm-hmm. The only thing I could do is eliminate lights, but that has to be a community-wide recommendation to do that.
Do we have a kilowatt hours that we know that we're using and then what we're projecting?
That would be something would be on the Unitil contract, and I don't carry that.
So Unitil is projecting this figure?
No, I'm projecting that figure based upon their bills.
Actual bills, yeah.
Do we have any areas that can be converted to LEDs?
We're actually doing it. Of course, some of the new lights that were put in, A, B, C, D streets, mm-hmm. those are all LEDs. Jennifer's working with a consultant that's taken our whole inventory, and they're going to come back to her and suggest, okay, these lights in this year, these lights in this year, and what our projected savings could, what it would cost us, and then what our savings could be. But she's relying on a third-party consultant to tell us that.
Good work, Matt.
Elaine?
Yep.
Yeah. I'm aware that Manchester has got a grant to change their street lighting to LED. Is that something that Hampton can look at?
Yeah, we could. Said. But more than likely, the grant came from the utility itself. Yeah. Yeah. We have gotten Unitil grants before. For instance, Church Street Pump Station was a pretty big one. We're in for a generator upgrade this year. I'm sure Unitil will be kicking in on that. But that's how the... The tough part about that is, for instance, the 216 money, it's already committed.
Yeah, well, Unitil's happy with the rate, so.
Yeah, exactly. All right, we're going to move on to municipal sanitation. The wages are the wages that you see down there. Teresa's given us a breakout. When we talk about municipal sanitation, what we've just jumped into is actually wastewater treatment. You can see the number of SEA people down there, the two chief operator, the wastewater operations manager. The rest of it's done to COLA contracts. There's a line in there for part-time wages, 56.42. We've had difficulty in the past of finding people to work part-time. To cover, if you will, different shifts. We actually have someone who's going to start in the next
week.
2 weeks.
Hopefully
next week. A young lady that has a grade 4 operator's license. She runs a seasonal wastewater treatment plant. She's going to come in and work for the staff. That'll allow them, she'll be there for holiday coverage. I think we've got her in for 3 days a week. Which is great because it's somebody who's really experienced, but she's never been in a 1.5 or 3 MGD plant. Her plant is 5,000 gallons a day, but Star Island. So that plant is shut down for the year, so she's going to come work for us for a couple of months. That'll probably eat up that 56, but Rob Pierce has had his foot worked on. He's in an air cast. We've got other people in other situations, and this will be a great benefit to us at this time. Overtime wages at $28,660 is really a function of a lot. They happen all the time, from loss of power to the press kicking out. Some of the things are being handled off site. Actually, the chief operator and the operations manager, through the system that operates the plants and what's known as the computer system, is a SCADA system. They can actually at home open this up, look at it, and tell what the problem is, and even remotely from town shut some things off. In other words, if one pump kicked out, they can actually kick on another one remotely. So we are taking steps to limit this line, to keep this line in containment, but there's some things like deragging a pump. can't be avoided. You don't know when it's going to lag up, and if it's the only pump, for instance, you take the Merrill Street pump station. There's other pump stations that are going through that station. You can't wait. You have to go down and address the call at 2 o'clock in the morning. And that's what that line really is for.
It also includes holidays and weekends required by the law.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone knows, but we actually do, you know, 4 hours every day, even on Saturday and Sunday for lab work. You know, Christmas Day, somebody starts their morning off by going on up, grabbing lab samples.
This is overtime you're talking about.
Yeah. So it goes on. Engineering services, I think I might have lightly touched on that before, especially in the sewer and drain division. We're always needing the expertise of outside engineers with respect to, this year we're looking at connecting generators, an emergency generator for the blowers, getting the blowers resized. They're very inefficient in size. And there's other things like that that are continually going on. The other thing that you should be aware of, we're into the seventh or eighth year of a five-year permit. We're still waiting on our operational permit to be reissued by the EPA out of the Boston office. The guy who was working on it retired, so they gave it to another guy. Hopefully he'll get it done before his retirement. So
this also accounts for some engineering's needs for sewer and drain that you had touched on upon before, when you need to replace an outfall and it needs permitting through DES or wetlands. Some of the things, many of those things we can handle in-house, but there are certain things that you need certifications for to do the permitting application.
Lab analysis, staff development, all these guys are, because we're a grade four plant or a level four plant, a number of the guys are required to have grade four licenses. I think three or four of the guys have a grade four. I know one of the guys, the newest gentleman in the plant, just took his grade two license exam yesterday. We won't know what the results are for another week or two. So everybody has got to be licensed, and everybody has to be recertified on an annual basis, re-educated or continually educated to maintain those licenses. Jumping all the way down to electric, we are asking for 230. To give you a reference, 214, the amount was just shy of 212 in dollars, and in 213 it was 192,000.
But this year, year to date annualized is 242.
Well, understand that,
and rates have risen from what I gather.
Bulk, it's tough to annualize electrical costs because that 13-week period that we have, you know, we see the flows jump up dramatically. In other words, today, 1.62 million gallons per day. July 4th weekend, 3.5 every single day. And got a tinge hotter, it would have tipped over 4. And last summer, it regularly tipped over 4 MGD. Those kind of numbers jack the amount of, because the load's there in the plant, the amount of bugs in the aeration lagoons feeding on that load require more oxygen to stay alive and to do their job. The more food they get, the more air they need. There are floats in those lagoons that sense what that aeration amount is, and it can't deplete. If it depletes, I either use it up, bacteria die, and it's almost like a nuclear reaction, if you will. It's cyclical. And then what happens is we get too many bugs leaving the plant, which means we'd have to use more chlorine. I give you this mini lesson, but that's really what it is. So the electrical, it's hard to say over a 12-month period, you know, 20,000, 30,000, you know, and look at it in a month, because it's a function of the dry summer we had, the number of people who went to the beach, how well is Smutty Nose Brewery doing? How much beer are they selling? They'll offload waste to us. You can go in the headworks, and instead of it smelling like sewage, it smells like beer. Because overnight, they sent us 30,000 gallons of brewery waste. Strong stuff. A lot of BOD load. Takes a lot of bugs. Takes a lot of electricity to to...
So you're comfortable with 2:30?
I'm comfortable with 2:30.
Okay.
Heating fuel, it's broken down by the actual plant itself, but there's also all the pump stations. They're all needed to keep them warm. We have generators in there. Of course, we have the pumps in there. They crack. I'm going on the next line, and on the top page 41 is water. There again, why do we have water in those various accounts? Industrial drive. Well, if you're deragging a pump, I can tell you you're going to need some water. If you have to reprime these pumps, some of them take 20 and 30 gallons just to reprime them to get them back going. You just can't. I suppose you could open up the plug on the top and open up the effluent line, and when you smell it or see it, hopefully get the plug. But they try not to do that. They try and reprime the pump with real cleaner water. So that's why we have water accounts at those. Uniform rental is based, it is what it is. There again, the guys are, now that they're aware of the boot policy, they're replacing their boots on a more regular basis. These are guys I want to replace their boots on a more regular basis. Mm-hmm. They're dealing with wet conditions, electrical hazards, potentially, slip situations.
Heavy pumps.
So they need the, not only, they need the electrical protection, they need the puncture protection from the bottom, they need the toe protection. So they get the best boots there are out there. And sludge tipping fees, we've given you what we typically will get rid of in tons of sludge. We're paying $75 a ton. It's still going to waste management. I think we have another contract through the end of 16, or do we have to rebid it?
I think it goes through 16.
Yeah, I know we checked it when we were redoing solid waste. And also the grit. The grit is over at the septic receiving area. When the wastewater comes in the plant, we actually have a system of screens and other things that actually pull grit out of the wastewater. The grit can be beach sand washed off people's feet. It can be grit from 100 other sources. It's important to get that out, because if we don't, it wears out the pipes and it actually wears out the pumps.
Oh, this is Rochester charging us, right?
Yes.
So is this, do they go up every year? I mean, are they increasing?
They go up.
In accordance, yeah. So the rates this year went up in accordance with the Boston
CPIU,
yeah. So basically, this year, and I need to look at my notes. So
CPI was less than 1% this year.
Yeah, but it's Consumer Price Index Urban, right, which is, in other words, it's not nationalized. It's for that area.
So it's adjusted yearly by that, but you have to understand then there's also environmental fees and fuel surcharges for the removal of it. So you add that all together, and that's what gives you the price.
Well, I'm sure we're not... another reason that they could be charging us more, which is not the case, is we'd be delivering wet sludge, but yeah, this is not the case.
Well, it's...
I mean, you know, it's...
It looks dry, but...
Well, yeah, but I mean, from a water content point of view, with right, the new press and all, I don't think that's an issue.
No, I agree.
But, so it's really, you're telling me regulation-orientated or CPI-orientated or...
Yep.
And that's their... I mean, that wording is straight from their contract. I mean, that's how they're rated.
That's what I wanted for a little bit of insight here. I didn't know why this was going on.
Grease disposal, we pump out grease from a number of these pump stations on a regular basis. It comes from restaurants, households, it comes from everywhere. We find grease even in our lines in the residential neighborhood. So, but it collects in an area or outside at the wastewater treatment plant, but it also collects in each one of the pump stations. If we regularly use an outside hauler like Crisco or somebody like that to go and pull that material out for us.
Where is this grease stored or held until we dispose of it?
It isn't. It actually literally floats like a cake in the top of all these wet wells.
So you go suck it off the top. You go to each site that has them and you suck it out.
Is there any risk of fire or anything with this grease? I mean,
no. No, it's
It's fatty grease.
It's fatty grease. It looks more like Crisco than, you know.
So how often do we skim this or whatever?
Well, we do plant checks daily, all in the course of a week, in the course of every 2 days, all the plants get rechecked.
When you say plants, you don't mean pump stations.
The pump station gets checked daily, but there's, so on an as-needed basis. So for instance, Church Street Pump Station, off in the winter, there might not be much grease accumulating in there. But all of a sudden, that last, right after Seafood Festival, all the restaurants are shut down.
Yeah.
We might see an increase in grease in there, and we'd have to go in and get it.
So you actually vacuum it off the top or skim it off the top?
Yeah.
And will you collect it in a truck and then?
They collect in the truck and then it goes to a separate plant. We don't take it to our plant. Plant that has the capability to.
You have this grease storing on your site?
We have one tank area where the way it's designed, the grease floats to the top. It's kind of a pass
through. On your facility.
Okay, Jerry, you killed the grease issue.
Is the grease coming from the restaurants, or are they just pouring
it? Comes from everybody. It comes from, you know, we find it in the residential neighborhoods. We find it.
Yeah, well, people tend to pour it down the sink.
Yeah.
Cook a chicken and then let it.
Excuse me.
Thaw, and you'll see the grease at the top.
Put it in your mouth.
We still have a lot to go through. Let's go back to the protocol we have, and let Chris finish in this section, and then the next question is Tim's, but I'd like to finish. Let Chris finish this section. Please don't interrupt. Hands up, guys. Thank you.
The next section is the supplies and expenses. As you can see, it's over a wide range of areas that they spend. Lab supplies cost an awful lot. I know a month ago they asked for $2,000 worth of lab supplies. I think it cut them down to $500. I'll be surprised if they make it to the end of the year with those. Lubricants really hit them up a lot, and they also have a big need for computer upgrades. They're continually automating the system. We, out of this, pay for a gentleman to update the SCADA system, the computer system. He literally adds components or things online, makes the system more efficient every single time he's in. Gasoline and diesel fuel lines again have been adjusted by the finance department. It just goes back to the number of gallons that we've average used, but they've made other arrangements for those. And vehicle maintenance, $33,000. We're maintaining for them under those, mainly the two sludge trucks. We make sure that we use them alternately because we don't want to wear one out over the other. But the other thing that happens is because they're in the sludge bay, they're handling sludge. There are polymers, there's chemicals in it that's in the air. There's a lot more wear and tear or deterioration on these trucks than you'd normally see. And then on top of that, when we put them up in the landfill and they'll dump a load of sludge, sometimes they can't get out. I've actually seen the front clavius pins bent on them where they staff at waste management help pull them out of the landfill because they get stuck. So these particular vehicles do get an awful lot of wear and tear. So like once you'll notice one line is a normal tire replacement. There's nothing normal about it. When a tire gets slashed because it came out of the landfill, we have to replace it. And we don't put retreads on this truck for that reason. Chemicals is under a contract. There again, we can pretty much track what we've used within range, but we bid this out. So it's a contractual item at $143.60. I'll jump down to replacement equipment. What are we looking for in this area? We're looking for the Arius sewer camera that we have, and we jet regularly all our sewer lines, clean them, and then we video inspect them. That's how we find out where we've got, if you will, major leaks, groundwater infiltration, or a new connection, or sump pump that's not supposed to be connected. You'll actually see it jumping into the line. That camera needs some upgrades. It's about $60,000 worth of equipment, and Toby's got it in for some serious upgrades. New wheels, new umbilical cord, I call it, things of that nature. The other thing that they're looking for is on the backhoe, on the claw bucket, it's worn out. All the pins, rackets, the thumb doesn't close, it doesn't come together anymore. So at $3,000. And that's, let's see, did you want me to stop there? The total of wastewater administration?
So we can go around with the questions. Tim, you were on board?
Yes. Everyone's favorite topic, grease.
Oh, no.
Slippery slope.
Grease is a very broad category, but as a broad category, I think it to be highly recyclable. I know our current recycling contract doesn't cover it, but there are facilities in the world that do recycle grease, right?
Mm-hmm.
Have we looked into that? And ought we look into it, I guess, is another way of saying it.
I can ask the guys, but I think this is what they consider contaminated grease. I say that because I got once the opportunity to go up onto over at Sprague Energy, a tank car that people were bringing in grease that they got from restaurants.
Right.
That was grease that hadn't been contaminated with wastewater. It had literally been, if you will, sucked out of a fryer or something like that. There was also meat renderings and things like that. But when you look at our grease, it's like,
does it have a high water content or something?
Well, it looks more like the consistency of Fluffernutter.
Peanut butter.
Huh? Peanut
butter. Tastes
good.
Yeah, marshmallow.
Oh, okay.
Kind of like whip.
Fluffer.
I'm sorry, I'm not into that stuff.
No, and floating within it or contained within it is
poop.
All this stuff.
We're going to simplify this and move it right along.
Yeah. It's nasty. So I think.
So the grease is not. Not even close to, it's a composite of a variety of stuff, not just grease.
It's not similar to probably what you're referring to or thinking of. There's people out there that go to the restaurants and take their grease and they actually use it and burn it for fuel,
right,
and make money off of it.
Right.
I don't know this for a fact, and I think that's where we should go back to the guys and double check it. But this is a very different component made up of very different materials.
We call
materials.
It fog in the trade. It's made up of floatables, organics, and grease. So, I don't know what the organics are, and I don't know what the floatables are, but it's nasty.
No, maybe we should call it fog on the line instead of grease.
No,
but this basically is stuff that floats to the top after it sits in a man-made pond that you create, right?
Yeah.
And you skim it off, and then you've got some water.
Oh, it's got a huge water component to it.
That remains after you skim it, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And then do you further treat it with
no.
chemicals? Or
we just haul it away, and we pay to get rid of it.
No, I mean the water. You further treat the water that remains.
Oh, yeah. It literally stays in the tank. We just basically skim it or suck it off the top.
But at some point, you discharge the water somewhere, right?
Yeah, at another wastewater treatment plant. It's set up to handle, to treat, and break down fog.
So
you can actually get a whole other group of bugs to eat it.
Great. So you don't truck the water. I assume you pipe it.
No, we truck it.
Really, you truck
like
it?
Like a septic hauler.
Yeah?
A large septic hauler truck. That's what we hire.
And you're actually hiring some private enterprise to treat it further? I assume that there's been some analysis about doing our own treatment on site, saving the trucking costs, et cetera.
No, you have to build basically another level of plant.
Right.
Millions.
Right.
The quantity that we have, we're talking about the wet wells here.
Yeah, we get rid of 6,000 gallons worth of $6,000 worth of grease a year.
No, not talking about the grease, I'm talking about the water now. The water that was under the grease.
Oh, that just stays in the plant.
Okay.
Right. So
it just stays within the system. It's like taking the frosting off a cake. That's all we do.
Yeah, I'm not talking about
the
grease.
The water.
I'm not talking about the fog anymore. I'm talking about the water that was under the fog.
It stays there. It's
just treated further?
Yeah, that just stays in the plant. We don't really pump off water. We just pump off the grease.
Well, you can't keep accumulating water. You have to discharge it eventually. Right.
It circulates.
It circulates through the system, so you figure that well has an outlet, or if you're talking the plant, or if you're talking one of the pump stations.
The grease, yes, floats at the top, you take it away.
Grease is done.
Other water comes in, other dirty water comes in.
Yeah.
The water that's sitting in there moves out. It's circular, it gets pushed out from the water, keep coming in, so that heads down to the plant, to the next step in the process and goes. So it is, that stuff is treated in.
Heads down to the plant, that's the...
Heads down to the marsh, chlorinated and goes into eventual storage tank and released to the marsh.
A cup of water comes through the plant, 48 hours it leaves the plant, treated and cleaned.
Cleaned as in, not potable water at that point, right?
Well, I wouldn't want to drink it.
It's as clear as this, but I wouldn't drink it.
No, it is not, but our water leaving the plant is not potable.
No.
Right, it's not potable.
It's chlorinated and meet state's EPA regulations and specifications.
Again, I think we've exhausted this line.
I'm well off of grease. I'm now after the recycling of the water, because to me, water's becoming an increasingly scarce resource. And it seems to me that we're fairly close to turning that water, which looks like it's clean water, to actually be potable water. We went through another step. And I would like to, you know, throw that out there as something that might be worth thinking about.
I'm just trying to, are you saying taking the effluent out of our wastewater treatment plant and turning it into usable, drinkable water?
There are many.
I don't want to keep that water.
There are many municipalities that do that today.
Okay, I'm making sure I'm...
We're not there yet.
Yeah, that's beyond us. That would mean refacilitization.
Gentlemen, I'd like to...
I don't know what it means. That's what I'm saying. I think it might be useful to think about what it would mean.
The scope of this...
I want to move on from this one.
It's beyond tonight's scope.
Agreed. Just throwing off an idea.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions on this section? All right. Brian first, then Jerry.
I just have one quick question. You don't have a flatbed trailer or anything like that to move equipment around with?
We do. Well, for instance, tomorrow I have to move...
Where do I have to move?
Oh, I have to move one of the sidewalk snowplow tractors.
Right.
Up to, like, HP Fairfield. That I have a trailer for, but I don't have, let's say, a 20-ton trailer. I have a...
To move an excavator.
5-ton trailer, right.
Okay, has that ever been looked at to be put in the budget? Because it just seems like I see a lot of tractors and whatever getting mileage on that they shouldn't be getting.
No, we
not moving them by trailer.
I bet it's only
twice a year, maybe.
Maybe, yeah, twice a year.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, Jerry?
Yeah, I've got 3 or 4 questions.
Are they ones that are already written up?
Yeah, they're not. He's got answers. I want further explanation. I don't quite understand what I got here.
Okay.
All right. Going back, I've got about 3 or 4 questions. Mm-hmm. Going back to the wastewater treatment, we got 7 people in there, and that 50% of the wages for the sewer and drain people, and the other 50% is budgeted in the highway, streets, and bridges. I don't understand why that labor is in the wastewater part of it.
It's wastewater and sewer. The sewer collection is part of wastewater treatment. So 50% of the wages come out of the wastewater treatment, and 50% come out of drains, because drains are part of the highway system.
So you got 50% of the wages are for sewer and drain people.
Yes.
Sewer and drain people.
Yes.
Sewer.
They're not working in the wastewater treatment plant?
They are not. They're working on the sewer and drain crew.
On the streets.
Basically on the road, yes.
A collection system. It brings it to the plant.
The other 50% is budgeted for highway, streets, and bridges, full-time wages. I don't get, what's that?
That's the drainage portion of it. Drainage is not wastewater.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't go to the wastewater treatment plant. This sewer and drain crew does both jobs. They do drains in the street, and they do wastewater collections also in the street, but it's collecting wastewater. Mm-hmm. So the wages come out of a different account. When we account for how much it costs to treat wastewater,
yeah,
you have to account for how much it costs to collect it and how much it costs to repair and replace the collection system.
But 7 people full-time work in the wastewater plant.
Yes.
All right. Hired equipment summer. We have $200 budgeted. And I got, looks lean. We got $3,900 spent year to date, and the last 3 years you averaged $1,400, and you're asking for $200. Is that enough?
Yep.
Okay. Supplies and expense, $81,000. Looks low. Year-to-date spending annualized is almost $97,000. In the last 3 years, you averaged $96,000. And yet you're only asking for $81,000. Is that enough?
You're going to have to make it work.
It's going to be your budget, I guess. Vehicle maintenance, $33,000. Looks low. Annualized for this year, in the last 4 years, is $44,000.
I'm going to make every effort to make it work. I'm trying to stay with, you know, this a budget less than, you know, or 0.29% less than what I proposed last year.
Keep a tight reins.
Tight reins, I agree.
Keep that reins tight. Replacement equipment, $11,000. Sewer camera and backhoe claw bucket is related to...
You already mentioned that.
You explain it to him.
No. Yeah. Goes under the back
it's
of the back.
Jaw bucket. Yeah. Opens up.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, it goes in a wastewater?
No. Well, they have
collection
a backhoe.
Sewers. The collection system's got to just keep remembering that drains and sewer department.
Ah.
The sewer goes with the wastewater treatment plant.
Okay.
That's why it's in there.
Thank you.
I got you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nick?
Hopefully mine will be very, very brief. I've kind of taken a look at computers and IT stuff because that's the subcommittee I sit on. One of the things I noticed, and it's going back a little bit, line suffix 3410, telephone, something just jumped out at me. Cell phones, 162 per quarter employee reimbursement. Can you just explain the policy or what's going on with the... reimbursing employees' cell phone.
I get like same thing as them. I get $81 every quarter for using my personal cell phone that everybody has that number can call me 24/7.
Okay.
So I was given the choice. You can either carry two cell phones or use your own number. I elected to carry just
one.
Okay. And that's why I get
reimbursed. Okay. That was for, and then it was just a clarification. The second one. Under line 6100, computer needs, WWTP and office. You touched on earlier that the computer needs for the wastewater treatment plant gets, am I to understand it's the system is controlled by computer system, somebody standing there overlooking everything, making sure it's good. This is directly access to the wastewater treatment plant, or is this computer needs for like the administration purposes in the office as well?
Both.
Okay. That's all I had.
Some of the plant air is kind of caustic. Mm-hmm. If you were to take a brand new copper penny and lay it on the table, come back a week later, it's totally oxidized.
Yeah.
Because of the amount of sulfide air. Sulfides that's in the air that continually turns over within the plant. So it has a real rough time on
the electronic like computer. Equipment. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Yep.
Going on?
Going on.
Let's see. Solid waste collection. There's five people. One's a part time, right? Okay. All full time. Headed up by Mark Richardson. There again.
This is solid waste collection.
Yeah, Ryan Sharp and Company. See, I'm already was trying to deposit it. So this is our five operators. The Packers, sidearm Packers, and the rear load Packers that you see. We also have a significant portion of part-time wages, and that's a lot of that is the summer. Some of you are aware, we collect trash 7 days a week during the summer, that 13-week period. The Saturday and Sunday morning shifts are 3 hours long. Then there's also overtime wages, and that's to cover
weekends.
In the summertime. Recycle hauling at $52,000 is, there again, it's contractual. I think that part went up. But you should be aware that we do not pay for recycling. I'd like to get that over the airways. We don't pay for the recycled material. We have a 5-year contract with Wheel Liberator Technologies. They take it at $0. If it makes money, that's to their benefit. If it loses money, we don't pay. We are one of only, I'm aware of, two or three communities in the state that have that opportunity. A lot of other people in the state are paying for their recycled material to be disposed of. This community does not, because we generate a big enough volume. Teresa's giving you the breakdown. Right now, we're paying $325 a load. It's going down to Bill Rick of Mass. After July 1, we paid $338 a load. $338.20. And that's how we figured that out. The tonnage on recycling the last few years has, I think, been within 10 or 20 tons. And that equates to about one trailer load. So that's pretty amazing that you can look at that flow and see that, even given the varied population that we have, that we stay pretty consistent.
Has that percentage gone up at all?
It's about 30, 31. It hovers. It you know, it changes up a couple of decimal points up or down. But it's a fairly good and consistent number. Better than some communities, but not as good as a few other communities. Mm-hmm. I think Durham outclasses us, but the only reason why they do that, when you look at the base population, is because the students, they're all required to, like, for instance, read the Wall Street Journal, and then they recycle the Wall Street Journal. So their paper numbers are huge, which draws everything up. Let's see, I did have a lot of breakdown here. Hazardous waste collection, if you're on page 43 and you see the 20,000 in the upper right hand corner, realize it's not in the budget.
I have a question on recycle hauling, Madam Chairman.
Not just yet, thanks.
Is that the end? Yep.
Let's let them go through this section.
Okay. So that's been moved to a warrant article that's supported by the selectmen 5-0. Diesel fuel, again, ask Christy. Vehicle maintenance.
Packers require.
Yeah, these Packers are killing us. Two of them this year alone have had there's a hydraulic pump on the front. Two of them had that hydraulic pump replaced. $9,000 each. Last year alone, those three Packers ate up $18,000 in budget. This year alone, they're easily gonna go 25 to 30. Between the number of hydraulic hoses on them and the number of moving parts, they're a killer, budget-wise. Am I going to be able to hold this line, Jerry, at 50,600? Only by the grace of God, because joysticks—they've had to replace joysticks in them because you know, the cameras, the backup cameras. Those trucks are killing me.
Yeah, the comment was is that when we didn't have them, we had a lot of people out with back injuries.
Well,
yeah, but the barrel kickers took care of that.
And they do pick up. I think they average about 75 carts an hour, whereas the rear packers are about 50 carts an hour. So they are quicker that way. I will admit that.
And less people.
But when we get ready to replace these, I'm going to be looking for trucks with less moving parts. Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, we've already started the search. Yeah. Consultants have been in, and we're also, these are very expensive trucks to purchase. We're not going to, that's another ball of wax.
Sorry.
Yes. Yeah. Collection bins. We did buy just under $10,000 worth of bins this year. We got 180 of them for the 10,000, the various sizes and assortments. Do we need 180? Yeah. Between what we plowed under this year and ripped the wheels and tops off of, yeah. That and other people sucked them into their snow blowers and plow trucks.
Or they moved away and took them with them.
Yeah, or they moved away and took them with them, or some of them went out to sea. So. Or at least out in the marsh. I could go on. Landfill operations, three quarters of the way down, there's a $7,000 line for monitoring inspections.
Yeah.
We bid that out. The bids came in a week and a half ago. That number needs to be revised to $7,900 under contract. It would remain the same this year and next year. We bid it out as a biannual contract. All the other numbers with respect to stay the same. Waste tipping fees, that would be for the municipal solid waste itself. You can see Teresa put down there, the number of tons. We got a really nice price. I think we were paying in the $71, $72 a ton range before we rebid. We're now paying $60.25 a ton. That contract is set for the next 5 years as far as CPI and how much it'll go up. So we're in a very good position there. And the same thing with the demo. We're only paying, demolition material, same thing. We're only paying $60.25 a ton. I say only because there's other communities that are paying a lot more, $80, $90, and $100. So we're doing very well when it comes to that. And as I said, we do charge for that, 6 cents a ton. So pretty much what we, some items I make money on, some items I don't, but pretty much that's a break even revenue-wise. So it doesn't, it's really not a, other than the hauling, is not a costing program. And then, of course, that next line down, the municipal solid waste limit explains to you how many loads of 133 loads from January to June and what that's going to cost, and the demolition material, what that's going to cost. Do you want me to go on to the transfer station and run through that?
Let's take a pause for the cause and go around the table.
I have one question.
Anybody but Jerry Richmond? Right, very good.
Recycle hauling. I went back through the records and some of the selectmen shows and finally got comfortable with the tipping fees with the new contract and for demolition and for regular trash and so on. When it came to recycling, I correlate with what you said about we're not getting charged for the disposing, for the hauling of the recyclers. But we are getting charged for the disposing. Or vice versa. We get charged for the hauling of it, not the disposing.
Correct.
But what I came up with was from this outfit called Commonwealth Trucking, $177,329 for 5 years averages out to be about $36,37 a year. Okay. And you've got 52. And that's the only thing I'm stuck on with respect to the implementation of the new contract, if you will. And did the new contract get implemented like last May or June?
July 1.
Okay, so it's 6 months. So we're really still in the first year of the contract. The first 6 months of this 16.
Yep.
So on the recycle hauling is the only problem I got stuck on, because all I saw was $177,329 for Commonwealth Trucking, and it had a 3% inflation rate, blah blah blah. And I figured, well, all right, $35,000, $36,000, $37,000 a year on average, and I'm seeing 52. Can you help me with that?
Sure. Recycling tonnage from July to December of this year will be approximately 15-19 in tons. Comes to 87 trips times 325 a trip, comes to $28,275. After January, down into June, it'll be about, well, it'll be 1,195 tons. This is recycling, 71 trips when we average what we push in each container. The price will jump up to $338 a load, comes to $23,998 for a total of $52,273.
So when they went,
it's going to be difficult to annualize their contract and
their bid, didn't they have $177,329 for the recycling in that contract?
No, the contract was bid. Tell us what you want for year one, year two, year three, year four, and year five.
I thought they came in with $177,329.
No, there was no total number like that. If you got a total number, you had to do some calculating, because it is based on a per load.
Okay, I'll take another look. Okay.
All the transportation contracts are per load.
Okay. Then I'll have to go back and do a little bit more looking at that.
Okay.
That was my only comment on the new contract that we have. The rest of the numbers kind of fit in. It's
You should be aware, the first time we bid it, they gave us a price of $350 a haul.
Oh, I know.
Then we rebid it, and they gave us a price of $325 a haul. And they were the only bidder. So they didn't need to dive, but they did.
Okay, any other questions on this section so we can move on? All right. Okay. Chris, we'll let you continue.
Transfer station. 4 full-time employees and 1 part-time employee. Thank you. We have Jim Hafey. Jim runs the plant, is the lead operator for the transfer station 3 out of 4 weekends per year. comes under the part-time wages that you see the second one down. The overtime wages at 78 are for, we have sign-up sheets for the rest of our staff to supplement that labor weekends. does some, Marie Hall does some, staff-wide, everybody picks and chooses. It's done on a kind of a rotating seniority basis, but everybody gets a shot at working in the transfer station if they choose to do so. But they are paid under the overtime wages, correct?
Correct.
Telephone, self-explanatory. Staff development. 27 people have to maintain a solid waste operator certificate if they want to work in the transfer station. And 14 people are available to run the scale. I know, Teresa, you...
No.
Marie does. Oh.
Dan Coughlin.
Dan Coughlin is the primary scale house. Yeah, to work in that scale, you have to actually be certified by the state. You just can't. So we pay for about 14 people. It's biannually.
Biannually.
I looked down at that word and it threw me. And it was important for the staff to note that in 2016, there won't be not be a fee until
17,
right? Because they finally shifted to a 2-year renewal.
Yeah, we just did them this year, so we won't do them.
So that. Next year you won't see that in the budget, but then the year after that, Jerry will be asking me, why did it go up?
Yeah.
I'll say.
Come on.
Yeah. But he's doing his job, if he does.
Biannual.
Yeah, thank you. Electric at 89.10. A lot of that is just to run the compactor. I think there is electric heat in the building, but there is heating fuel, water. They do a lot of washing down, we hope. They have a pretty, given what they handle, they have a pretty low repairs and maintenance line at 14,000. The gas line has been shaved down to 686, and the diesel line has been cut down to 4,400. we gave Christy the gallons we used, and she did her magic. Screening and grinding, that's the stump dump area out back in the big brush pile. We bid that out. It's a $9,000 a year contract. I think it occurs every 6 months or so, or when we call him, typically when it's happening. I know he's scheduled, we talked to him yesterday or today, he's scheduled to do it before the end of the year. So that's really the total of the transfer station operation at 342 and change.
All right, questions on this one? I have just one on the overtime and wages. It looks like you're a victim here of the default budget that's been running along for a while now.
Yeah.
And it looks like you're chronically using way more than that line. Just want to point that out to everybody. I mean, there does come a point when you keep doing a default budget that sooner or later you are really using more than you can strip out of something. So in 2014 you've used 85,000. This year you're already over at 63, and this I'm looking at the end of September's figure. Jerry's probably greater than what you're looking at, and we're budgeting for 78.
Talking about overtime wages, Madam Chair?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, my concern there is that if you continue to underfund that every year, if you get hit with a default budget again, you're going to be looking at, you know, a deficit right there. that he's going to have to take out of someplace else. At some point, we've got to get real about the budget and put money in where it needs to be.
I agree.
And if the public is listening out there, there are times you don't like it, but when you take those kind of numbers out of someplace else, you're not doing something. You're eliminating something on the to-do list. And I know that we sit here and we look for ways that we can trim things, but that's not all that we're about, and that's a fine example on that line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's no way that that'll come in a default number.
Right.
All right, sorry for the commercial, but I think sometimes we need to show that we go the other way, too, in what we're looking at. Anybody else in this section? Jerry, I'll give you a turn, but I want to give somebody else a turn if they have it.
I just have a quick one. Under repairs or anything with vehicles, is everything you're doing for repairing the vehicles in your budget just for you and not for police, fire?
Yes.
Okay.
There's like three vehicle maintenance lines, one's highway, one's solid waste, and one's
wastewater,
thank you.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't carry a line for fire equipment. I don't carry a line for fire, police. I don't.
That was my only question. Thank
I do like, for instance, we do we'll repair the recreation vehicle department vehicles, but I don't. It's that we'll do inter-department transfers and handle that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Jerry.
Yeah. Again, I see accounts here that look low to me. Staff development looks low. You're 1350 year to date. Annualize that, it's 3292 and 2735 over the last 3 years. And you look low on what you're asking for there. That development, you're asking for 1350.
I've had to tell the guys, a number of the guys know. I have a $200 bill from one of the guys sitting on my desk that wants to get compensated before the end of the year, and I pray to him that I find the money. He's already put it out of his pocket. This is where, as a department head, we had to make some tough choices. Do I present to you a budget in excess of the, you know, the last year's amount, total amount, or do I had to pick which ones were truth in lending, and the ones I could control, I had to bite.
I'm just looking for reality, that's all.
This is reality.
Yep. Electric looks low, 89.10 in light of electric rate increases we've seen in other budgets, fire, police, and so on. So electric looks low to me as well. 89.10 is what you're asking for. Repairs and maintenance looks low. 14,000 looks low. A year to date annualizes almost 16.
Well, I'll give
last
you
four years
for instance
it's been
on that,
19.
Jerry.
Yeah.
We had a hydraulic leak in one of the compactors.
Yeah.
So rather than calling down, let's say, Atlantic Recycling and their team to come look at it, we went in, took my vehicle mechanics. We cleaned the whole mess. Then we had the vehicle mechanics go over and look at it. And as it was, they could replace it. Repaired it for like $50, a couple of fittings. So decisions like that are having to get made. Are those harder decisions? Some people think they are. I just say we need to look at it ourselves before we throw this outside consultants, outside concerns. And that's
supplies and expense look low to me.
Right.
Your annualized is 4390, and your last 4 years average is 5194, and you're asking for 3500. So you're going to have to hold a tight rein on all of these accounts, it's possible.
It is possible. I tell you, between, and it's...
Which is good.
Marie comes to me, Teresa comes to me, Jennifer comes to me, Mark comes to me. Everybody's coming in with their requests, and they're getting some unbelievable scrutiny. And there's a pile on my desk. And some of them are just not getting approved. And I'm straight out with them. Won't approve it.
I think we need, you know... Frugality is a very good policy. Be prudent, be frugal, be tough, be conservative, but mm-hmm. be real.
Yeah.
If we need it, we need it.
If it's a safety-related item within the department, there is no, it's approved. There is no holding back.
Or if it's a functional.
Well,
most
of the time, functionality and safety are going hand in hand. So. But
it's metaphysical.
My predecessor went to the annual meeting for the American Public Works Association. I had no budget to do that. I was denying a lot of my staff from going to training. I didn't go.
Jan, you got to help here.
That's my job.
The man needs help.
You know, I'm going to throw something in here only because we're on this subject, but there's been some recent criticism that things are being not handled as well as they could be from equipment standpoint. And this training says a lot. You have people that are undertrained, or feels that way.
Well,
I mean,
if
you
the training's required...
You inherited a problem.
Right. If the training's required for them to keep a license, keep up to speed, it's not denied. Because it won't deny... You know, I don't want anyone to lose their... For instance, a grade 4 wastewater operator. I'm not going to hold it back, but I'm not going to let them go to 7 conferences when 4 meets his requirement.
Right.
Because he'd like to go to the other 3.
But are there areas where enhanced training will actually take better care of the facility in the end?
I would have to say yes. It's almost an obvious yes. But in what area or what aspect?
It's not
aspects?
A trick question. It's
right,
just,
no.
You know, it's one thing to sit at the end and complain.
Right.
But to correct it, mm-hmm. and we're underspending in the training, well, I've been in a lot of jobs where it's my job to train people, and if you're not training people, you can't blame them if you haven't trained them. And if you have a budget that's reducing that and you're not giving them every opportunity to get trained. I mean, we can't take every excuse
We're trying
away.
To find other sources, for instance, like, you know, the guys are required to get their CDL license.
Mm-hmm.
Keith went online and found a program that they could actually sit at one of our computers and go through the atypical exam. And I think 2 or 3 people have used it already, and it helps them because they're not used to taking tests on a regular basis. So instead of sending them a class, I think we only spent like $58 for the software package. So we're doing things like that.
There are alternatives to going to outside for training,
mm-hmm.
using your peers, using mm-hmm. your coworkers, using someone who knows how to do it. So I do look at this line item and go, it is controllable. There are other ways to get knowledge.
Okay.
You don't have to be sent mm-hmm. to a paid class.
True.
Sometimes it's great.
Like that hydraulic repair that I mentioned, when they figured out what kind of hydraulic pump it was or control unit, they actually went out on the internet and got the parts diagram and the assembly diagram. Then they went over and looked at it. So they did it smartly
mm-hmm.
versus, as I say, calling Atlantic Recycling.
Well, it's amazing.
Sounds
well,
like a good thinking process, and I like what I'm hearing, but you're going to have to hold tight reins here, Chris. I don't know when I step back and look at it all how I'm going to feel, but I've seen an awful lot of under but now I consider this low budgeting with respect to historical past, year-to-date spending over the last 4 years, but I hear what you're saying, and now I got to step back and think about it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions here so we can get to the last section? Okay.
Let's see.
Sewer collection and disposal.
Sewer line to maintenance at $130,000. That nasty four-letter word messed up over the last couple of years. We have identified projects that we are going to proceed on. For instance, Ann's Lane, I'd like to slip line about 700 feet of pipe. I don't want to dig it up. I want to try slip lining.
Mm-hmm.
Begrudgingly, my staff is going to allow me to do that. They'd rather dig it up. But as I explained to them, I don't have all the money in the world. It's another alternative solution.
It's a pipe within a pipe type of thing.
Yeah, it's a pipe within a pipe. I'd lose a quarter inch of the size. Essentially what they do is they pull an epoxy impregnated cloth down the middle.
Yeah.
Push air behind it, blows up, and then they send down a ultraviolet light. It cures it in a matter of minutes.
Just for leakage.
You're done. Yeah, they pressure test at either end, they're done. Because Ann's Lane is half clay pipe and half plastic pipe. I'd like to re-mill and pave Ann's Lane, but I won't do it until I handle the sewer line below it. Now, on an interesting note, we've identified an area on Lafayette Road located between Galley Hatch and Dunkin' Donuts. The pipe's missing. Half of the pipe's missing, the top half.
Missing pipe.
Gone, not even there.
Well,
we are gonna dig that up, and so we are gonna spend this $130,000, and that's where part of that is gonna go. So we have identified those two key projects, and that's where that money's gonna go.
Half of the pipe is missing?
Yeah.
I don't get that.
Clay, cracks. It's like an eggshell.
Oh, you mean it's there, but...
No.
It's all broken.
It flowed away.
Oh, it goes away.
So what's happening to the flow through the pipe or whatever?
It's in the bottom half of the pipe.
Yeah. What's the pipe used for?
Sewer.
Carrying the sewer. So we got a leakage. We got it's draining into the soil.
I have some INI coming in that location, right? Water infiltrating the pipe.
Wow.
So when we discovered that, we pulled it up, and that's what we're going to do. Exeter Sewer Agreement, we have a number of homes out in the Warner Street area, Warner Road area. They flow into Exeter, if anyone's aware of that. That's an agreement with them. We have to pay $7,000 a year for those homes. And wastewater treatment plant maintenance, it's one of those lines they're going to have to live with. But they have something like 675 pieces of equipment, and when you average it out, it isn't much for equipment at $55,000, but it's one of those things that if it can be disassembled and repaired by staff in-house, that's the way we do it.
Mm-hmm.
It only leaves when, let's say, it's a major pump. I'll say that we have three raw pumps when the effluent comes into the plant. One of them developed a leak. We literally lift it out and for $5,000, got it repacked and rebuilt. Too big for our staff to do. But anything else, we do it. That's it.
All right. Sandy?
And so when your staff does it, they're trained to do that.
Yeah.
So, Chris, how are they trained if we're not?
The lead operator is a licensed plumber with the state. The second guy down is probably one of the best lab operators in all of New England, because he and three other guys have won awards for doing it every single time. Then you've got guys like Steve Aslan with 17 years of experience and others. There's a wealth of experience to draw from to get it done.
I understand that there's a wealth of experience, but we all know that there's continual training. In every single thing, police, fire, whatever, there's always training, because
right.
There's always a new development, newer way to do things. So
there's a new sludge pump going in, or I forget what the dollar number is, $47,000. I'll grab that out of the air. That's what strikes me. But we're actually paying for that out of that wastewater access fee. And because it is newer technology, we reached agreement with the supplier. He's going to install it. It's going to run for 6 months. Then once it's approved and we accept it, then we pay for it. So they'll show us on that new technology how to install it and how to maintain it. And we'll get rid of a pump that's costing me $6,000 a year for a rubber hose fitting that breaks every 6 months.
Many of the manufacturers offer training for their components, whether it's a pump station or this Penn Valley pump we're talking about. Even if we're not paying them to install it, their reps, their pump, their reputation's on the line. Mm-hmm. So it goes back, it's not necessarily training where you have to send somebody to do something, but it's having someone show by example, it's having someone come in and oversee.
It just seems to me that it's kind of like a fly by the seat of your pants. I'm sorry, but now I'm a firm believer.
Not so much with respect to wastewater, because pipe and water really hasn't changed in 100 years.
Yeah, I agree with Jerry. I really think you're low on some of the stuff.
The training.
I really do. I really think you are. I think that when we do a final review, we might want to...
Yeah, we haven't gotten carried away at all with this request.
I know. You guys, public work never gets carried away with anything. I know.
Mm-hmm.
So, I know it's held pretty tight.
Yeah.
And you're also the sacrificial lamb.
Oh, yeah.
Every time something's needed somewhere.
Right. Take it out of public work.
We're aware of that.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that Jennifer and I are looking at, and Jerry, and it goes to how are we going to manage that, is we're going to extract a little bit of money out of a lot of these accounts to buy basically what we call it an asset management system. every task that needs to get done, from taking down a tree to replacing a sign to cleaning out a basin, is going to get added into this, and there's going to be a lot of accountability to this. People, we already use this particular system in this wastewater treatment plant. You instituted it, or were part of it. It's that JobCal system.
Yep.
All the tasks to run that plant are on that menu on a daily basis.
Oh, yeah.
If Mike Doobie's sick, those five other guys or six other guys know that they can go in there, log into that system, and it tells them these things need to be checked, fixed, corrected, adjusted, or cleaned today.
Yep.
We're going to do the same thing with Public Works, the rest of Public Works, from catch basin cleaning to, and that will hold staff accountable. It'll optimize where they go. It'll make sure, it'll basically cut down on a lot of stuff that Jennifer and I do. Did the sign get corrected? Did the client, did the resident get serviced? Did that tree in the front yard get picked up? Did that Christmas tree that we missed in January 15th get picked up? All these things will, there will be some accountability for that.
Chris, what's the cost of that system?
It ranges. Right now, we're looking at three different systems. What they give you and what you buy, that's what the range goes for. Mm-hmm. We're not just looking at it for cost, so we'll be completely blunt there. We also want it to be usable, not just for us, but other people that potentially may use it. Looking at surrounding communities and who's using what one, so that if employees were to interchange with the upcoming stormwater regs and those type of things, there's a lot of information that can be shared. So being on the same systems as other municipalities is also
a So will we see this point. In 2016, or is this going to be pushed
Oh,
out?
We're hoping we see it in 2016.
Okay.
It's also needed to address that stormwater permitting issue.
And that's included within the budget, not a warrant article.
Correct.
Okay. Jerry?
Yeah, there's a few things. The sewer line maintenance, Chris.
Mm-hmm.
$130,000, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're asking. Your four-year average spending has been $23,000.
Yep.
And now the air clears, the clouds get blown away, and you're going to be able to spend $130,000. See, that's what I see with the trees, which we never spent the money that we've allocated, the roads, the sidewalk, all of these things that we have never spent to the budget line, we're now automatically going to spend to the budget line. That troubles me. All of these things together, when you take the sidewalks and the trees and the storm drains, 160 outfalls and the roads and the sewer maintenance, all of these budgeted line items, which we've put money in the budgets in the past, and they just have not been used, the budget, the money. And you're asking us to trust you that you're going to spend this year, and you've already got a plan. You've
given
Ann's Lane 700 feet of pipe, and Lafayette Road with missing pipe, and whatever else is going to eat
you. Jerry, given the sidewalks that we've repaired, the trees we have cut down, and the roads that we have paved,
yeah,
I think the proof's in the pudding that the group sitting before you will get things done.
Well,
that's all I can say.
We have to remain optimistic.
Well, it's just, you know, it's holding people accountable and directing them to do it. You know, the sidewalks outside didn't get done because somebody else invented it getting done. Said, Toby, Friday, Jane's out of her office. You need to show up at noontime and jackhammer those so she doesn't have to listen to the noise. So we came for two Fridays in a row and jackhammered it all out. Then Frank came over and dug it all out and prepped the bases. And Dana Anderson, who I hired as the cement guy, worked with there again on a Friday afternoon, and they got them poured. And that, it takes us setting the pace and the direction and pointing them and just telling them to do it.
Well, it's all management, isn't it?
It is. It gets down to management. So I'm not a, I don't want to spend a lot of time thinking about, like, doing another study of roads to tell me that I need to pave roads, okay?
Thank you.
Give me the money to pave the roads.
You'll go do it.
We'll argue about which ones till we're blue in the face. I'll concede, you know, I'll get some, Fred will get some, you'll get some, Mike will get some. We'll all, but they'll get paved. They'll get refurbished crack sealing. First time this year we did crack sealing.
You have enough human resources to do all these things that we've never seemed to do simultaneously now.
Urban tree to cut the trees, XYZ to do the crack sealing, GMI to do the paving. I'm not going to do it all.
Yeah.
But am I going to set the pace and set the direction? Yeah.
One other comment here, Chris. Now, maybe I'm misinterpreting this. It was wastewater treatment plant maintenance. When I read that, I thought of preventative maintenance. But I'm not, I guess I didn't hear that when you were talking about it. You were hearing about actually replacing pumps that are missing.
You know,
because preventative maintenance has to be done.
I agree.
Yeah. And so this wastewater
the
treatment plant maintenance.
The same question was asked the other night of the fire department.
Yeah.
The radios, are you going to maintain them or replace them?
Both.
Well, if the radio's 4 years old and it's been through a couple of fires at over 1,000 degrees, it's kind of a moot point whether you're maintaining or replacing it. It's worn out.
Preventative maintenance.
Jerry, job cal every single day. All those numbers
are
preventative
maintenance. So the job cal is still being
held. Still being used.
Still being disciplined.
I'm still getting the daily reports, the reds and the yellows.
Right. But this is actual maintenance going on right here, this wastewater treatment plant maintenance where a pump fails and has to be replaced or something like that. It's actual fixing.
Or replacing.
Or replacing. It's not PMing.
Right.
PMing is under the wastewater treatment.
You'll get a PM to go in and clean the chloride pump.
Yeah.
That doesn't tell you that 3 months later the chloride pump's going to crap up.
If it craps out, you've got to replace it, you got to fix it.
We replace it.
So this is strictly maintenance.
Well, call what you want, but.
No, but the difference between preventative maintenance and actual replacement or fixing. Something that has just failed.
It sounds like this line covers both.
I think the word you're looking for is repair, Jerry.
Repair, yeah.
Or if you change the oil in your car, did you repair it or maintain it?
Maintain it. The oil doesn't get broken.
Yeah, but you took the filter off, so you replaced that.
Well, no, you said change the oil. You didn't say the filter.
Sandy, you have a question.
Your last 3 years' average here for this line item has been 87,000, almost 88,000, and you're telling him to do it for 55.
There's a new sheriff in town.
New sheriff.
We'll do it in best we can with the money you give us.
Okay. Well, this is your budget. I mean, you know, or a budget that was certainly approved.
And working with others, it's the budget that we could all live for, that we felt that you folks could support.
Thank you.
I'm done with the comments.
Thank you. Sandy?
The cutting of the trees. Are you going out, having a outside company come in and do those?
We bid out emergency tree removal services. Mm-hmm. And for the last couple of years, Urban Tree Service out of Rochester has been awarded that bid. We then used that bid as the basis for, come look at this tree, the one at 41 River Road that's 80 feet tall and is deader than a doornail. That particular tree will require a crane to take off the top because the wires are so close.
Yeah.
So we use the bid as a basis, but then there are extenuating circumstances that some things require a crane, some things require, the neighbor might say, hey, I want all the wood, okay. They actually charge me more to cut it up into 4 foot lengths than if it was just chipped.
But so, you're not expecting your guys to do it.
No, I'm not, because we're spread way too thin.
Okay,
we have enough other things to do.
Okay, and I will say that this is your budget.
Yeah.
And there are some things I am concerned about in your budget that we may change, upgrade.
Do you want to give us more money?
When we get into final review, but I will, and I do support your budget and all the things that the public works do above and beyond the community and serving their community. And you have a good crew down there. They do a great job. I don't think they get thanked for everything that they do. So
Mr.
Yeah, thank everyone down there for us.
We will. Thank you.
They do work hard. I mean, the transfer station people are great. They help out. The wastewater treatment people are in the thick of things, if you know what I mean.
Yep.
The real low end of the totem pole in terms of the job they have to do. But they are very competent in their work. The highway people are out there plowing and picking up trash. I mean, you do have a good crew. They seem to be competent and conscientious.
They are.
Yeah.
Chris, we're going to let you off the hook here and get you out of here. But before you go, do you want to say that this is your, you know, this is not your first round with us, but it's the first round with us being in charge.
Right.
And I see a lot of effectiveness that's going to go on. Leadership and your management and your team. Teresa, you've been here before, always knowledgeable. And Jen, this is your first tour. We didn't hurt you too much. But I didn't want you to leave without saying that this was a very well prepared budget on your part as a team, all three of you. And even with short notice on information that we needed to gather, you were very expeditious in getting the answers out to us. I'm grateful for that. Grateful for taking the time tonight to answer all of our questions. I think that makes a huge difference to us, each and every one on this committee, to determine what we will have your budget be as it goes forward. Thank you tonight. Thank you for your time and your endurance. I know it ran a little late, but there's no way to do a $5 million budget in 10 minutes, unfortunately. And it is an opportunity for the public to get an explanation to things that they never even thought about or even cared about.
Yep.
And it's just one big number, and it's, oh my God, what do they do with all that money? And quite honestly, I think sometimes you work miracles with what you do have.
Yep.
So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
We might see you at warrant article time.
Oh, I'm sure you will.
Or bond, right,
or
Jen?
Bond. Yeah.
Right now, I have the time. It's 9:27. 10-minute break, and I know we're running late. There was no way to avoid it, but we have to knock off some of these minutes.
Do we need a 10-minute break?
Yes.
I need a 10-minute break because I've got to go grab some stuff.
She's got like 15 books in her car. We got to help her with.
Yeah.
Well, look at all.
Start on November 3rd.
November 3rd.
Welcome back, everybody. We are going to move on to approval of several sets of minutes. So,
I'll make a motion to approve November 3rd's minutes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Scott has a second. I'm saying that because at home that she can't see who's on the screen. All right. Well, November 3rd, I have one thing that I want to correct. It's going to recur in several sets of minutes. I don't think that Terry knows that Maureen and Bob and
Chuck
are interchangeable, because she has Bob present at this one, but Maureen absent. Maureen wasn't absent. So I'll give her a call and explain that. So the only correction I have on this one is to delete Maureen Buckley's name under absent. All right.
I have a correction.
Okay.
Or at least a comment. On page 3.
Yeah.
It says chairman near the bottom, the last bottom third. Chairman Latimer asked what the income is for your department. That big paragraph underneath that, see me here?
Yep.
It says when Kevin Schultz was here, the line items I may not have been spending them down, and he's right. And I identified those line items as staff improvement and uniform expense. Now, if you wish to put that in there, that would make that more complete. But the two line items he wasn't spending down on were staff improvement and uniform expense.
Okay.
That's all I have for this one.
All right. Anything else on that one? Okay. In favor of approving as amended? Okay. Any abstentions? Phil, I didn't see a vote from you.
Everybody's
on board. Great. Okay.
Can you vote? Did you vote?
Moving on to November 5th.
So moved.
Okay, second. Again, just adding something in. Usually we notate the village district representative, and in this case, again, Maureen should have village district representative next to her name, and Bob, you weren't there, but you weren't absent. So she needs to strike that line, because Maureen was here in your place that night. Any other corrections to...
I only have one comment, and that is on page 2, where it comes to municipal insurance.
Okay.
There's a lot of stuff there, however, we did really not go through municipal insurance, we didn't review it, because she didn't have the final figures, blah, blah, blah. So that is one section of the budget we still gotta go back to. When I read this, I didn't come away with that thought.
Well, we had, so you want added that we would, this would be revisited?
Yes. Yet to be, yeah, municipal insurance, yet to complete, so to speak.
Okay, so at the end of workers' compensation is $600,584. This topic will be revisited?
Yeah, municipal insurance will be revisited for this topic. Or right up when it says paragraph C, municipal insurance, yet to be complete. I don't care how you do it. It's really yet to be completed.
But we need notation in here that it will be revisited.
Well, I think we are, aren't we? We're gonna revisit that, yeah. That's all.
Is everybody okay with that?
Yep.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Oh, wait a minute, who moved that?
I did, and I seconded.
Mike moved it?
I seconded.
And, okay.
I'm abstaining.
Mike moved, Mike seconded, Sandy's abstaining.
And I'm abstaining.
Bob's abstaining, for obvious reasons.
That's true.
Okay. Going on to the 12th, I need somebody to move that?
Move it.
Okay, Nick moved it. Mike, you wanna second it? All right, again here, I want to delete Maureen Buckley, because we had Bob at that meeting as the representative. And then on page 3, we're midway down in the page where it says, Mr. Dina said, the position has not had an increase since 2002. I'd like added to that, upon further questioning by Mrs. Latimer, Mr. Dina said, current individual has been there 1 year. Okay, if you recall that conversation about...
Was that the 10% raise that he gave?
No, that was the part-time secretary position that was going from $10 to $11 an hour. He said the position had never gotten a raise since 2002. Right. However, when we questioned it a little bit more, that person had only been there a year.
Right.
Okay, that's... I think that's the only thing I have on that one.
I have a couple of comments.
You have a couple?
Yeah.
Okay.
The first one I had was when Mr. Tinker was here, we did an awful lot of poking at his legal costs or his consulting costs, and he did give us a subsequent analysis of where all of that went. And I don't think he mentioned that anywhere in here.
But it didn't happen during the meeting. Minutes are supposed to reflect the meeting, Jerry.
I know, but we did poke at what it was he was.
Okay.
And you he did put the speak word, to it. He
you
spoke.
You want to put the word poke?
A lot of poking going on.
We queried him. We queried him on it. He gave us a verbal answer as to where it went, and then he subsequently gave us something in writing. But we don't talk about anything in here about that fact that we queried him on his legal costs or consulting costs.
Okay.
So you want the query of legal costs in there?
Yes.
Got it.
And also you can make an attachment with the sheet he actually sent us. Do you want to do that, Jerry?
I don't really feel that's necessary, Mike.
That should go in the minutes of the meeting after we receive it.
Yeah.
Okay, so we don't forget.
And I have another comment on this one.
And in the record.
All right, so where do you want to put that we queried Mr. Taker?
We queried him on his legal costs.
Where?
Well, anywhere in his section, that makes sense.
The end.
At the end of it,
All right, so put it at the end.
Yeah.
Mr. Tinker was queried on his...
Contracted, what's it called?
Outside legal costs, consulting costs.
Contracted services.
Contracted services.
Contracted services.
Were irregular, and we queried him, and he seemingly had some good answers, and he backed them up with...
We're not going to put all that in there. I'm just going to put that Mr. Tinker was queried about his outside contractual costs.
Yeah,
that's good.
Now, I have a comment on the Conservation Commission.
I'm sorry?
Are we really done with conservation?
There's no gas on this.
For the moment, in these minutes, I believe we are.
There's no mention of gas.
Any other changes to the minutes?
Technically, Jerry, we're not done with anything yet.
We're not done.
Well, I mean, didn't we ask him about the accounts and we were going to research the accounts?
Yes, and we're getting that information.
We're just talking about the minutes, that's all.
Yeah.
We're getting that information from the treasurer, Jerry. In fact, it was just delivered to her by the finance, delivered to the chair by the finance director during break. I'm sure it will be forthcoming to us.
We'll be talking about that later.
So is the Conservation Commission going to, are we going to talk with J.D. again on this subject?
Well, we haven't come to that question yet. It doesn't belong in the minutes.
Correct. In the minutes, Madam Chair, if I may, it does say Chairman Latimer asked Mrs. Polium to look into what clarification of the two funds, how they are listed, and the differences between uses. Also, can personnel increases come out of these funds? So that's, and I believe that's representative of what we talked about at the meeting.
We have had other questions since.
Even though we have yet to follow up on it with the treasurer, that is reflective of what went down in the meeting.
Right.
I would say that's accurate.
Again, any more changes to this set of minutes?
All in favor?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Over here?
I didn't check the.
Sandy, are you abstaining on that one?
No, I was here.
Okay, so unanimous on that, everybody? Good, let's move on.
I'm torn, I'm going to abstain on that.
You're abstaining?
Yeah.
Why are you abstaining?
Because I'm torn.
All right.
Don't query him on it.
You abstain.
Don't ask any questions. Let's keep this ball rolling.
All right, now moving on to November 17. Again, deleting Maureen Buckley because we had Chuck Rage that night. Anything here, guys?
No.
No?
Any complaints?
I really didn't.
Any queries?
Any pokes?
Okay.
No queries.
No queries.
I'll move it.
Second.
I'm abstaining.
You're abstaining?
I'm abstaining.
All right, let's start with all those in favor.
Because I am so torn.
Okay, those abstaining, Bob, Jerry, Sandy, and those opposing.
I favor.
Thank you, only the other one you didn't like. December 1st.
I'll move December 1st.
Second.
Take it.
Okay, I have a couple of changes here. On the first page, third set from the bottom, starts Chairman Latimer. Said last night, the selectmen approved 3, 4, and 6 of the consent agenda of 11/17 and asked Fred if we would have it by Thursday or Friday. Not, and we will have it. It's just I asked him.
Yes, that was.
It wasn't a command.
You've been very diplomatic, so I would agree with that without even reading or remembering it.
Thank you.
I'll agree without remembering.
Nice to have you vote of confidence, Mike.
We can do tonight's class.
All right. And then on the next page, number 5 will require this one. I think I have to go back and check the script because it seems like there's confusion on that amount. It doesn't, I'm not sure that whole section is right.
Where are you?
On page 2.
Where on page 2?
Right at the very top.
Right at the top?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Is that in regards to the undesignated fund balance?
Well, we were talking about the undesignated fund balance, and the figure will be between 400 and 500,000. It sounds like almost like what we thought was going to be left, or that didn't have a logic to it when the way it's written.
No, that's inaccurate. It's going to be either 4 to 5 million.
4.5 million.
I would say we table these minutes and move them to the next meeting.
Yeah, good idea.
For a correction there. All right. So pending whatever that is.
Well, that would be the correction, 4 to 5 million.
Right, and then further down.
That'd be correct. That's almost a direct quote, as I recall it, don't you?
We are tabling it, right?
Yeah. Well, no, I want to get through with whatever the corrections are so that next week we can just fix that line and
that's
sail
between
through it.
4 and 5 million, but
so
that's.
Yes, so we should.
look at the video, because there seems to be broad confusion from everybody.
No, I don't think there is any confusion.
There's no confusion except with you.
It's just...
It turned out to be 4.5 million.
4.5 million is what he's been saying. Everybody's been saying, but between 4
and
5
million.
Yeah, that's exactly what he said.
It's 4 and 5.
I don't think that's the only point that I'm hearing from other members.
No, that's the only, that's...
No, they even brought up at one of these meetings.
That's the point. Everyone has a different opinion on it.
Madam Chair, let's take the vote, and we can deal with the vote.
All right, I'm not done yet.
Okay.
Okay, going further down, about a quarter of the way off the bottom. Says Chairman Latimer said if that request was rewarded, it should be rewarded, not rewarded.
Reworked is right.
Okay.
They were fleshing over the policy side versus operational side.
Let's put it out there that we change it to 4 to 5 million, and if we review the tape and it seems otherwise, we'll reopen it for discussion at the next one.
We'll have our astute Mr. Tim Jones verify that for us.
All those in favor?
Yes.
Opposed? Jones? Abstained? Jerry? And Bob? Okay, December 3rd. Any...
Oh, wait a minute, did you forget the 29th?
No, we'll do, I'm not doing that one tonight. I just did this set.
Okay.
All right. On this one, on page 1, Chairman Latimer said the audit is complete. That's not all that I said. I said I was informed that the main section of the audit was complete, and they were still waiting on capital assets to be completed. Changes things a little bit.
That sounds pretty accurate to me. As I recall.
Because that's how it was to me.
It's their starting memory, right?
I have a pitch on my nose, Mr. Jones.
And then, going to page 3, now this is coming off, hello down there. This is coming off the conversation about overtime and how overtime is used if you have big fires, if you remember that. We questioned the overtime.
Yeah, I remember that.
And he said, well, you know, you don't know what you're gonna use. If you have a couple of big fires, you're gonna use it. If you don't, you don't use it. And that's why this is partially right, but isn't totally right. The next page, page 3, right on top, Chairman Latimer said, we have added a lot of property, but if we do not use it, that would be great. Well, it sounds like we've added a lot of property, and we're not gonna use the property. Actually, Chairman Latimer said, we have added a lot of property, so the requested amount is reasonable. Okay, but if we do not use that, that would be great. That's, put it in a context that makes more sense.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is difficult. I give credit to anybody who actually does the minutes for the couple of months that I did them. Oh, you don't ever want me as a secretary, I'll tell you.
Are well-written minutes.
They are very well-written minutes. They're very documented, and it, you know, just...
Pretty good.
It just need a little bit more context, so anybody who wasn't here that night knows what we were talking about.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
What page are you on?
Well, I was moving to 5, but I think you're gonna stop me in my tracks, right?
Just above training, I should say.
What page is he on?
No page.
Between 4 and 5.
I'm there.
Under fire prevention.
Yeah.
Second paragraph, says Mr. Jones said has heard wonderful things. The fire prevention secretary, and she made this operation more efficient, and she saved the town a lot of money. I think that needs to be corrected to be more reflective of my grammatical precision when I speak.
Excuse me.
So please do be precise so that we can make the correction.
Well, I think, actually I prefer Jones. I think you can save a lot of typing with this, dropping this Mr. stuff. But in any case, Jones said he has, I guess the word he needs to put in, he has heard wonderful things are happening with the fire prevention secretary.
Okay.
And she has made this operation far more efficient, and she has saved the town a ton of money.
Is that exactly what you said, or is that what you're bringing up right now?
Yeah, I mean, I was, I'm paraphrasing what I said, but if you want the full rant, I can give it to you.
No, that's okay, because...
We got it.
Sandy's sitting close enough, she vouched for you.
Yes, it was a continual.
Did you enjoy it? It was a great pleasure.
And I have one last...
It was a great pleasure.
I have one last thing here. Going down to almost the bottom, Chairman Latimer says she has done that. That was in response, Selectman Bean suggested that I talk to the chairman of the Board of Selectmen. I had done that.
Where are you?
I am on the almost the bottom of page five. Then the next sentence says, Chairman Latimer says she's done that, and I also requested from Selectman Bean that he bring it up at the next meeting. This was...
She's in the same minutes we have.
This was regarding the default budget.
Right. I remember that. I remember asking Phil to follow through. I remember that
because
part.
Because I said, Phil, you said you'd be happy to in the end, and I said, great, I'll be watching.
Right, you did say that.
But you didn't bring it up, so.
It's not part of the minutes, Madam Chair.
No, but... I still have the same request. Monday night probably wasn't the night to kind of slip it in there, but if you can, next Monday night, we really do need the default budget. But that has nothing to do with the minutes. I'm just changing and putting that line in. Any other corrections?
All in favor?
I have another question.
You have another? Okay. Correction?
And a comment for the secretary. You know, it's a lot of work. I really appreciate that it is a lot of work.
Yes.
I know it is a lot of work. You know I know that it's a lot of work.
Right.
That's so, standing for you.
I hope that's not in the minutes.
But I want to suggest to her that she can save a lot of typing time if she just uses everyone's last names in the body of the minutes. Okay? For example, the motion that I'm about to correct is mine, where she writes in Timothy Citizen Jones. She did it quite great, but Jones would have been sufficient.
But you've corrected everybody with Citizen Jones, so she's now doing that.
Just saying, in the body of the minutes, the last names are all that's necessary.
Okay, we're not...
Motion that this request that you read by the chair, that needs to be rephrased. That this request that the chair just read.
I'm okay with it.
It's grammatically incorrect. Right. And it's my name's associated with it, and I prefer to be grammatically correct
when possible. Okay, so make the correction.
That's what I'm doing.
Okay. Are you done?
I motion that this request that the chairman just read... be sent by the chairman and the rest of it as an officer of the budget committee on behalf of the budget committee is to the town treasurer, seconded by the branch.
Okay.
Where is Steve today?
Are we done with corrections?
It's not in minutes.
It's almost tomorrow. all those in favor? Do I have a motion to accept?
Yes.
Yeah.
As amended.
As amended.
By one
as
and
amended.
All.
Yep. Okay.
Oh, who did? Who did the motion this time? Did I?
Who did the motion?
I don't know.
No. I'd be more than happy to make the motion.
Thank you, Nick.
Second. Motion and second. There we go.
Okay. I'll take the second from Brian. All right. All those in favor of accepting the minutes of December 3rd?
As amended.
As amended.
Yep.
All right.
Abstain.
Asleep. Okay. Opposed?
Abstain.
Okay. Wait a minute. I'm on opposed. And abstain?
Abstain.
So Sonny, Bob, Jim, and Jerry abstain.
Jerry, why are you abstaining?
I hadn't got a chance to read them.
Are you torn?
He is torn.
No, he abstained.
On to the next one.
Oh, that's it for tonight on those.
I thought you had
that's tonight's agenda.
That's tonight's
agenda.
Sorry, I'm trying to get the comfortable horse.
I did mention tonight if you wanted to do that.
Okay. Now, you have your budget books for the schools. That's next Tuesday. MIS has been moved to next Tuesday. It was supposed to be tonight, but we'd be here past midnight. So I moved that one. And you have a copy of all the warrant articles as they exist at the moment. That's what I have. If that's not in that pile, I don't have it.
Are they, do they have the tax impact on them? I mean,
no, they're not going to have the tax impact on them until the end. Something that, especially for the new people and even for the old people. No, I mean, people that have served before. You got to remember that we used to just go till the end and get all of the warrant articles all at one time. And last year and this year, they started working with us to let the information out sooner so that you could look it over and not get hit over the head all at the end. But you got to realize that none of these have to be finalized until we get to review. So these all may change, but keep on board with them. So no, we're not asking for the tax impact. When we get the final versions, and you will get the final versions, the tax impact will be on there. The votes will be on there. And their voting will be on there as well. But you don't. What you have right now are the draft wannabes, okay? That have been approved to send to us, okay? But they're still, if you want to look at it this way, there's still a draft subject to change.
How many are there here?
I'm not, I think there's 17 pages.
23 are here?
There's 23. I've got a, I'm keeping a list.
Yeah, there's another package.
And I've got, it's 2.6 million, and I'm dividing it up, saying, okay, this is, the source is the undesignated fund, the source is the police fund, the highway grant, the tax collection of the recreation fund, so I've kind of got a matrix going, and as we...
You've done an excellent job of
So the hard copies you sent to us in digital form, right, today?
Everything you have there, is I also sent you digitally. Good. I had to send it in two files because it was too big for one.
Is that work you're doing, Scott?
Okay, but I wanted to...
Which would be far more valuable if we're done, you know, it was sent to us digitally.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, yep. But I just, it's just too early, I thought.
Okay,
you know?
one more thing I want to go over. We did request information from Ellen Lavin, who did send over, and she did not do it digitally because it has to do with bank accounts and that. She sent me copies of the originals. I just got them. Yeah. I'll try to put it in some sort of logic to either go over with you guys or however. I don't, at first I'm seeing them. Okay, but I'll try to put it together in some way
to show us how big it is. Oh, there's just like one line on each page, though, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm just looking at this.
One line on each page.
Well, she was very thorough in giving us the stuff, so.
Are we getting that information tonight?
We appreciate that.
No.
I just got it tonight. Mm. All right.
So tomorrow morning, then?
But it was hand delivered by her, and then it was hand delivered here, so, you know, sometimes some things you can't do instantly. And we didn't want to send these things out.
Is she going to come in at all?
Well, we're going to decide after we analyze.
We'll decide after we see this. But we did talk at length, again, about all the different accounts and what I was looking for. And that's why she sent this bundle. There actually are three, but we'll go over that Tuesday. Okay. Right. One of them that is... And I've got to go through this to see the actual names, but one that we didn't talk much about turns out to be an account that came in before Ellen was even on board, that went back to like the power plant years ago, where there was a almost like a grant.
Let's not do a partial
that
update.
Ended up.
Let's get the
yeah,
whole thing.
It's just I know you're
okay.
Curious,
we'll
but
hold that.
You know, just letting you know the information is coming in, so. With that, do I have a motion to
adjourn? Motion to adjourn.
No, you have an agenda item called correspondence that's there for a reason. What was the reason?
I do have correspondence, but this is it.
Yeah.
How did you know that was coming? It wasn't given to you at the break.
I knew it was coming.
Motion at 10:05.
Second.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
No, it isn't.
Is it Tuesday?
Yeah.